heavily. Always so well groomed.
The flowing locks of Reveille, huh?
The Fightin' Texas Aggie Band. And the Corps of Cadets, 2,700 strong, ready to cheer on Texas A&M. Their fourth home game of the season already. Head coach Kevin Sumlin. Welcome to the SEC on ESPN. This is a great stop in college football. College Station, Texas. 1-1 SMU tonight against the 10th-ranked Aggies of Texas A&M. From deep in the heart of Texas, we say hello alongside my partner, Matt Stinchcomb, former Georgia All-American. I'm Clay Matvick. Don Davenport will be along shortly. And Matt, these Aggies left it all on the field last week against Alabama, came up short. How will they respond here tonight?
Well, there's so much left to play for. There's about 9 nuggets of inspiration left on this schedule. And when you look at what A&M did a year ago, able to unseat Alabama, who went on to be the best team in the country, they didn't get done this year. And yet, there's still a lot of football left to be played in the West Division. Ultimately, you just want to get to the Georgia Dome. You want to get to the SEC Championship game. And they can do that largely due to the contributions of their quarterback, Johnny Manziel, who a week ago, despite 2 interceptions, still continues to build on his legendary status.
Well, if you like offense, this game is for you tonight. SMU, like Texas A&M, spreads it out. They throw it almost every down. June Jones hired Hal Mumme in the offseason, and it's meant a lot of passing yards.
Yeah, it's going to be an exciting ball game. The ball's going to be in the air for almost the entirety of this ball game. And you can see these two offenses, they rattle a lot of plays off. 84 plays a game for SMU, a much quicker pace than they employed a year ago. 75 for A&M, and they want to get faster. Coach Sumlin shared that with us. He wants his quarterback and his offensive unit to stand on the gas, but it's the production, the disparity in points that really leaps out. 27 points a game for SMU, 52 leading the SEC for Texas A&M.
Kevin Sumlin, last year's SEC Coach of the Year. Top 3 in total offense 4 of the last 5 seasons. That's going back to his time as head coach with Houston. And there is June Jones. June helped bring SMU back from the abyss after a 25-year drought, which included the death penalty years. He's led the Mustangs to 4 straight bowl games. Texas A&M won the toss and they elected to defer. SMU will start with the football. Taylor Bertolette puts it into the end zone, and they're going to bring it out. Jabryce Taylor, the true freshman, making an early mistake for the Mustangs as he's driven down at the 8-yard line.
Jabryce Taylor, well, that's a gutty move to try to come out there and get your offensive field position. The idea here today for SMU is to see if they can't get started early. And I think Jabryce Taylor, he would have been better advised to go ahead and take a knee. You see there, the 12th man in and around the football. They send their 12th man down on kickoffs down here.
And Sam Miller, the sophomore from San Antonio, wearing that special jersey again tonight as Garrett Gilbert brings the SMU offense out. Second year as the starter after a transfer from Texas. And Prescott Ryan in the backfield with it. You bet, they'll throw on first down. Crossing route, it's complete. Keenan Holman, the senior out of Beaumont, makes the catch. And he's run out of bounds after a gain of 8.
Expect a lot of completions out of Garrett Gilbert. 38 completions a ball game. They air it out, 55 attempts a game. You can expect him to complete balls. The question will be, will A&M allow this passing game to get vertical and pick up yards in chunks?
On second and two, Gilbert had it knocked down at the line. There is Julian Obioha. He's wearing number 90 tonight to honor Polo Manikainen, who was killed in a car accident back in July. He's a freshman defensive lineman for the Aggies. Someone else will wear that jersey number next week. So a third down situation right out of the gate for SMU. Caught by Line, and he's got the first down. Prescott Line, Zach Line's younger brother. And he's built like a fullback, just like his brother.
Yeah, a lot of catches out of the backfield. You know, effectively, this acts like a sweep play for SMU, able to get their running back out wide, almost like a long handoff on the completion.
In the flat, another completion. This is Darius Joseph, and he leads the nation with 11.5 catches per game, but there's a penalty flag on the play. It's a gain of 8. We'll see if it stands up. John McNade.
Number 18 of the offense. 10-yard penalty. First down.
He's our referee tonight, and it does go against SMU.
You see coming into your screen there. Yeah, it's almost like a tackle. Steven Nelson just trying to spring Joseph to pick up the yardage needed. We'll see some horizontal passes. You know, the marriage of these two offenses. And it'll be interesting to watch. Will A&M be patient enough to allow SMU to complete passes in front of them?
Line makes the catch. He is tough to bring down. A Parade All-American, former Michigan Mr. Football. That's a gain of 6. For SMU on their opening series out to the 25-yard line.
Tony Hurd Jr. is the captain of the defense. They're going to challenge him as well. He's going to be a guy with 4 wide receivers on the field at all times. A&M will be in their nickel and dime packages the whole game.
Second and 14. Coming back to the football. Caught. Jabryce Taylor quickly wrapped up and driven down at the 30. Well short of the first down. So it's third and long coming up as we take a look at our Lee Jeans impact plays.
Well, we hit on Garrett Gilbert, the trigger man of a pass-happy offense at SMU. Darius Joseph on the receiving end of most of those passes. DeShazer Everett, note his position, moved from his corner spot to safety, largely because of the 4 wide receiver deployment that SMU stays in game one.
Gilbert, penalty flags down again. Holman the catch, first down and more, out close to midfield. But again, a penalty marker down. That was a big problem for SMU last week. They had 11 penalties in the game against Montana State.
Illegal formation. Tackle number 75 is off the line of scrimmage. 5-yard penalty, third down.
And this one, too, comes back.
I tell you what, that's an incredibly frustrating penalty. And you'll see June Jones over there lobbying. That's a call you don't see made very often. But when you're pass protecting often, you get the offensive tackles, they want to cheat back a little bit. This is a loud environment here at Kyle Field. You want to make sure that you're not forfeiting that first step to the defensive end. At that time, Chris Weeks off the line of scrimmage too much.
Nobody has sat down yet here in Kyle Field. Third and 13, Gilbert, crossing route, complete. Arias Holloman. Dropped. Fourth down, and the Mustangs will have to punt. Nate Askew making the tackle.
A&M, they talked about it on defense. They have to be better on third down. They have to get off the football field. This time aided by penalties, but regardless, able to get the stop, and now an opportunity for an at-bat of their offense.
Mike Loftus, a lot of pressure, got the kick away. And it bounces out of bounds. Going to be good field position for Johnny Manziel and the Texas A&M offense. Now Manziel, after last week, for most, he's the Heisman front runner again. 464 yards and 5 touchdowns passing and 562 total. You can see what he's done this season already.
380 yards of offense from the quarterback position. Heisman Trophy winner a year ago. Worked on his game during the offseason. And is actually upping his production as a passer this year.
looking to throw. Caught out of the backfield, Sabian Holmes gets a blocker downfield and close to the 20-yard line. The South Lake Carroll product, Sabian Holmes, a pickup of 32, a big play right out of the gate.
Yeah, and you can think about the aggressive nature of this offense and the trigger that they have at quarterback who can buy time and deliver the football downfield.
Now Molina, straight ahead. That's Ben Molina, the senior captain. Does so much for this team as a leader. Plows straight ahead inside the 15-yard line.
The big difference between these two teams, both of them like to spread it out, but it's the offensive front, I think, for A&M that is the biggest point of distinction, a powerful unit up front for the Aggies.
Second down and four, Manziel. All day to throw. He'll take off. Nifty move inside the five, out of the two. Just when you thought he was ready to surrender himself, he gets three or four more yards.
You see Manziel with his eyes downfield. He's got all day. There's no pressure, excellent protection. But because of the opportunity, you see him there, juke Kenneth Acker. That's an all-conference cornerback for SMU. Stays in bounds and picks up additional yardage.
Molina, the tailback, first and goal for the Aggies. Somebody jumped.
Illegal snap, number 56 of the offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
That's the center, Mike Matthews, one of the great Matthews brothers on that O-line for A&M.
The importance of the center position and what A&M does offensively because of the pace at which they play, however fast he can get over the football is what dictates how quickly they can run a play. That time, a little bit early with the snap.
I'll keep it on the ground, Trey Carson inside the 5-yard line. Back down to the two. Carson, first year playing with the Aggies after transferring from Oregon.
Get in the red zone. Oftentimes with the spread offenses, this is where they have difficulty. You can't spread a field that's condensed. Right now, A&M is playing on a 13-yard deep field with the end zone included. There's not that much space, but because they can run the football, it's an advantage that their offensive line affords it.
See what Manziel does here, second and goal. Molina, touchdown, and he walked right in. Said it before, how are these guys going to respond after last week's bubble burst? That's a pretty good response.
That was pretty authoritative, right? Defense comes out, does its job, gets a stop on third down. And when offense gets its opportunity, goes right down the football field. We saw flashes of what we'll see all season, what we've seen all previous year in 2012. Scrambling ability by Manziel and delivering the football on the run.
Five plays, 52 yards in under 2 minutes. They take advantage of great field position. 32 yards passing on the drive, 17 on the ground. Manziel and company out to a great start here in College Station. Energy. It is a lovely night here in College Station. A lot of rain last night. Johnny Manziel raining on SMU early. Quick opening scoring drive at 7-0.
Johnny Manziel, he's rained on many a defense's parade. When you look at what he did a week ago to an elite program like Alabama, surrendering 600 plus yards. You look at him, a lot of it coming from this guy right here, the quarterback position. 562 total yards. And that's not even the most he's ever had in his short career at Texas A&M. We're talking about a guy that's only gotten close to 15, 16 games under his belt.
The ball tipped off the tee for Taylor Bertolette as they're running up to the football. There is some wind, but it's mostly around the top of the stadium. Down in the bowl, it's not too bad. Somehow, though, gust knocked that ball over. Old Southwest Conference rivals meeting for the fourth time since the conference disbanded. Bertolette will kick it into the end zone again, and this time Taylor makes the right decision.
Smart play there. I'm willing to bet he got a talking to after the first offensive series. Give us a little room to work with to start off our offensive possession. But already, you know, A&M getting what they wanted defensively, getting SMU off the football field. Now they have to amend.
All right, Stinch, this defense for Texas A&M needs some work. Mark Snyder, the defensive coordinator, will be the first to tell you that. Moving some pieces around this week, Darian Claiborne, the starting middle linebacker this week, even though he's a true freshman, they're trying to find the right pieces in this puzzle.
It's a perfect offense to start with. Very simple. A lot of simple formations for SMU. They're either 2x2 or 3x1 with the receivers.
Number 75 offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
SMU had two penalties against them on their first series. Now one already before the first snap of the second series.
Well, you know, this is the cautionary tale. This is something that everybody should pay attention to. This is what a 12th man means. It's the crowd involvement. Already Chris Weeks trying to cheat back in his stance. Previously in the legal formation and now a false start.
First running play of the night for SMU. It's Casey Lemche, and he's turned upside down. It's going to be a gain of just one. Tony Hurd Jr., he's going to be busy tonight in that nickel position. He's the captain of the defense.
See the excellent job in run support. The Shazer Everett there. Tony Hurd Jr., as you mentioned, the wily veteran, might not be the fastest secondary player, but is always around the football.
We'll end around. Big hole for Jabryce Taylor. And he's finally ridden down at the 43-yard line. Taylor, very explosive. He broke all of Dez Bryant's school records at Lufkin High School here in Texas.
Razzle-dazzle with the fake handoff. And Jabryce coming around on, it was almost like a fly sweep, really. Get the defense to commit to one side of the formation and then capture the edge for a big gainer.
Gainer 22. Thrown again on first down. Incomplete. Keenan Holman couldn't bring it in. The offense the last couple of seasons for SMU under June Jones, entertaining. They're always up around 30 points per game.
Well, this year you see it down just a hair, and that's largely due to their difficulties in the red zone, turnovers, missed field goals already hampered them there.
Yet another penalty.
False start. Number 15 of the offense. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
June Jones shaking his head. Against Montana State, the penalties piled up. And against that FCS opponent, it almost got him beat. They won by a point over a team 2 weeks ago that they should have handled easily.
It took an 80-plus yard drive. Garrett Gilbert leading them down the field to come back and win. Well, already here tonight, you can see the crowd, though, is having an impact.
Second and 15, good protection. Now Gilbert pressured, flushed, still looking downfield. Now he's going to step up and run. Can't step out of the tackle at the 41-yard line, brought down by Nate Askew.
What this offense does oftentimes is they ask a running back to match up with an edge player. You see Nate Askew, he's picked up by Fine. It's almost Johnny Manziel time for Garrett Gilbert. He's pretty mobile, not nearly as elusive as Manziel, but trying to keep the play alive and able to get positive yardage on the scramble.
Gilbert leads SMU in rushing. Now he's facing a third and 12. This is where A&M has to step up, getting off the field on third down, and they're going to do it. Is that caught? They're going to say yes, that's a completion. No. Nope, this is going to be an incomplete pass. That was Tremaine Jacobs taking it to the end zone, but it's ruled incomplete.
There's a guy that we met with yesterday, Tony Hurd Jr. He's there to make the play we mentioned.
Rolling on the field is incomplete pass, fourth down.
He's always around the football, and he was in this instance as well. Watch him close. Looks like he got his helmet right on the football. The ball comes shooting out of Marcus Holyfield. Tremaine Jacobs there to pick it up. It ends up being an incomplete pass. See Tony Herd, though. We were visiting with Mark Snyder, defensive coordinator, yesterday. They knew that he might get stretched a little bit, but he's already made some good plays defensively here tonight.
Ben Molina is going to let the punt bounce at the 20. Takes an SMU roll, and it's dead at the 15-yard line. The most exciting player in college football, the reigning Heisman Trophy winner, set to go back to work on offense. Texas A&M leading at 7-0 over SMU here in the first.
ESPNU College Football Primetime is presented by the makers of 5-Hour Energy. Take it after lunch, be clear and alert for hours. And in part by GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
Just a great scene here in College Station before kickoff. The pageantry of college football. They do it as good as anybody.
You're exactly right. I'll tell you what, I don't even know how they keep up with the traditions that they have. There's so many of them. There's something constantly going on.
Manziel gives it to Molina on first down. This time they're ready for it. As Kevin Pope, the middle linebacker, leads the charge, that's going to be a loss on the play. Johnny Manziel last week, 562 yards of total offense, second in SEC history, only to his 576 against Louisiana Tech last year. Manziel taking off here. Gets it back to the 25-yard line. Zach Wood, the defensive end, makes the tackle. And there's a man down. Last two seasons against Alabama, he has been so impressive.
It's almost as if he steps up even more. You look at everybody else versus an Alabama defense that really, I think, could be reasonably said to be the measuring stick by which offenses can standardize their performance. You look at Johnny Manziel, though, you know, the yards per attempt, the touchdowns to interceptions, it outstrips everybody else. And then the yards per rush, you know, he was just 2 yards shy of having thrown for 400 yards and rushed for over 100 yards. The only other guy in the SEC history to have ever done that was Archie Manning, and he was going to do it versus Alabama.
And a player down for SMU. We'll check out him when we come back. Self Miner shaking up on that last play for SMU.
You see him right here at his defensive end position. He's actually the one that gets upfield quickly, doesn't bite on the play fake, and ends up flushing Johnny Manziel. And watch him hustle and cover down, make the tackle, but right there at the end, hit Ben Molina and injured his neck a little bit.
Manziel deep down the middle of the field for Evans. Caught to the 28-yard line. He wowed everybody last week. Probably going to have another big night here tonight.
Well, if he gets big yardage like that, one reception, right down the middle of the field, post pattern, he's coming across the coverage. And Mike Evans, a huge target, literally and figuratively, at 6'5".
A gain of 47. Second series for Texas A&M. Manziel. Now he's going to run. Still on his feet, first down. And so are penalty flags.
With a block in the back. Number 56 of the offense. 10-yard penalty, first down.
That's on Mike Matthews, the center. Mike Evans, an A&M record, 279 yards on 7 catches last week, including that 95-yard touchdown.
That really got A&M back into the ball game as things were starting to slip away. They jumped out to a lead. We were talking with the players and the coaches yesterday. When is Mike Evans not open? And they said it doesn't matter. He's always open, whether you're covering him or not. That was proven true last week.
They go back to Ben Molina. Spinning and then pulled back and dumped by Kevin Pope, who is going to spy Manziel. Here tonight, he's got good speed, closes in on Molina to throw him down.
Kevin Pope is a guy he's going to have to figure pretty prominently in SMU's defensive attack today, not only on Manziel, but also getting the ball carriers like Ben Molino on the ground on those inside runs.
Second and 11. Another delayed handoff. Molina, big hole up the middle. First down. And inside the 10-yard line, he's finally tackled by Greenbaum.
Coming right into your living room. Look at the opening. Well, the only guy that could have tackled Ben Molina was the umpire. Not an SMU defender even in the frame. Huge hole in the middle of the A&M offensive front.
On first and goal, Manziel. Going to run again. Walks in, touchdown. They are going through this SMU defense like butter.
They're having their way with them, that's for sure. You hit the big hitter to Mike Evans. But already we saw it a couple of instances on this drive. Johnny Manziel, who pressured on the very first play, but otherwise, he's got time, and he's dancing around in the pocket, and he also knows that he's got the ability. If I have to run, I can. There, he could have delivered the football as a passer and decided, you know what, I could just dance my way into the end zone.
Second rushing touchdown of the year for Johnny Football. It's a seven-play, 80-yard drive, and it's 14-0, Aggies.
The win, guys.
All right, Matt, bad news for the Florida Gators. Meanwhile, it's 14-0 here. Johnny Football with his 60th career touchdown. So what does this mean now for the Gators now that Tyler Murphy goes from backup to the guy at Florida?
Well, so much was made in the offseason about the skill sets of Jeff Driskel, his evolution as a passer. Well, other than poor decision-making in the red zone, and it sounds as if I'm diminishing the impact of that, he had a pretty good outing versus Miami. Seemed to have figured things out in the passing game, and that's no longer an issue.
Onside! Did Texas A&M recover? Yes, they did. They catch SMU napping. Taylor Bertolette recovered his own kick.
That's aggressive, huh? I don't know that A&M needed to steal a possession, but you know what? You look at the ball game, Kevin Sumlin and his coaching staff, if there's an opportunity, they're going to take it. What a well-executed onside kick. You can't kick those grenade kicks where they bounce it high anymore. If you're going to recover an onside kick, you almost need a kicker who's capable of dribbling it up there and then to recover it on his own. You've got an athletic kicker in Bertolette.
And now Johnny wants to throw on first down. He'll settle for three or four. Lee Jeans presents the impact players, and Mike Evans coming off that great week against Bama.
We've already hit on him, caught a big pass from Manziel earlier. He's almost the security blanket if Manziel ever needs it. And then you see, we mentioned Pope and Acker. Acker got juked on a quarterback run that ended up in the end zone, and Pope charged with spying on Johnny Manziel when he scrambles.
Into plus territory. Molina, after the catch, dives close to another first down. The strong side linebacker, Stephon Sanders, makes the tackle. So it's third and an easy yard or two.
We talk about the receivers on the other end of these passes from Johnny Manziel, but they're great blockers, too. Mike Evans, there, Malcolm Kennedy. They cover up the corners, they stalk block, they flat back defensive backs on these perimeter and screen runs.
Molina again. He's got the first down. There is Pope, who makes the tackle. Ben Molina, 11 carries for 42 yards and a touchdown last week against the Tide. We had a chance to talk to him yesterday. An impressive senior. Johnny Football is the face of this program, but this guy is the captain.
Yeah, you know, you look at him, they look for leadership on the sideline. You think about a week ago versus Alabama as that lead was eroding. You know, they have to do a lot of their leadership on the sideline because they don't huddle when they're on the field. And it's guys like Ben Molina that set the tone and what kept Aggies in that ballgame offensively.
First down from the 41. Happy feet again, complete. At the 31, caught by Darrell Walker. And the senior with a big play. Walker, A&M's number three receiver, has experience, a great speed. He gets 22. Texas, Kansas State, coming up on ABC tonight. Mack Brown and the Longhorns have been struggling. And another completion, about a yard short of the first down. There's Malcolm Kennedy. And no team is relishing the Longhorn struggles more than these Aggies.
And will likely benefit from the Longhorn struggles. They've already benefited from a strong season a year ago.
Quick strike. Manziel complete again to Kennedy, who had three touchdowns against the Crimson Tide last week.
And there you see, you know, Johnny Manziel. We talk about how he buys time. We were visiting with Tom Mason, D coordinator for SMU. He'll hold the football, but here delivering it on time, chipping away at the yardage left to get to the end zone.
Manziel to the end zone. Kennedy can't reach it. And he was covered by Greenbauer, the free safety. There's a marker on the field.
After the play was over, personal foul. Unnecessary roughness, number 74 of the offense. 15-yard penalty, second down.
That's on the right guard, Jermaine Effetti, the only rookie on that Texas A&M front. That's the first incompletion for Manziel tonight.
Jermaine Effetti, young guy, a guy that they think is going to really come on what's been a very strong tradition of excellent offensive linemen. A&M right now on the field, and Jake Matthews and Cedric DeBoye, maybe the top tackle tandem in college football today. When you think about, they lost the number two overall draft pick a year ago.
Yeah, we said that about A&M a season ago, that they're the best tackles. Tipped and intercepted. Hayden Greenbauer with the pick. Now, Johnny Manziel had a couple of interceptions last week, has one here tonight. There is a flag down.
Personal foul, unnecessary roughness. Number 70, the intercepting team. Penalties half the distance to the goal line. First down.
So it's SMU with the football, even though the penalty goes against the Mustangs.
Well, this time A&M actually makes the tackle, but a tipped ball. You see him trying to get it to Darrell Walker again. Deflects off his hands. Greenbauer right there to make the play. Mike Evans able to track him down and make the tackle. But you see right here, they're not going to let you go after the quarterback. I'll tell you what. The quarterback, once he delivers the football, he's considered a defenseless player. They threw the flag. Unnecessary roughness.
That was against Ely Nabushosi, the redshirt freshman. Gilbert dumped. And another penalty flag. Alonzo Williams, the defensive tackle, with the sack.
Personal foul. Grasping the face mask. Number 83, the defense. 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
But it's Alonzo Williams with the face mask.
That's one of the challenges. If you're going to throw the football a lot, you better be able to protect the passer. You see Garrett Gilbert. He feels the pressure. Get a piece of that face mask, though. It's an automatic personal foul. 15-yarder. He's talking about, look, I didn't mean it. I was just trying to make the sack. SMU has difficulty when they don't go into a full slide protection, when they turn their pass pro into like a running play. It's hard for them to keep defenders off their quarterback.
Casey Lenchi, the catch. And it's a 4-yard pickup, second down. Askew runs him out. A lot of short passes, as you said, and a lot of them are horizontal as opposed to vertical down the field. Run and shoot and air raid, different offenses.
They are, but right now you'll see it. They're just trying to get completions to where A&M will come up on the short passing game.
Prescott line about a yard short of the first down.
And you see right there, that's what they do. They pass to open up the run, but it's the passes that they've been able to deliver. And they haven't been downfield. They're so proximate to the line of scrimmage. And coming into this ball game, you see over half of the passes that SMU throws You know, their attempts are within 5 yards of the line of scrimmage, 15, 16% of them behind the line of scrimmage, and we've seen that ball out here tonight.
Caught! Great adjustment in midair by Steven Nelson, the junior receiver. And SMU converts the third down.
Right on cue. Talk about a back shoulder throw, and Steven Nelson feels it. Tremaine Jacobs just couldn't get turned around in time. Well, when we get done talking about all these passes around the line of scrimmage, they push the football downfield.
After the 17-yard completion, another pass and catch. That's a 9-yard pickup for Holman. Garrett Gilbert leads the nation with 38 completions per game. He's 8 of 11 here tonight. Another short pass, Darius Joseph to the 36-yard line. Joseph had the game-winning touchdown catch with 12 seconds left to beat Montana State 2 weeks ago. They move the chains. Line. As SMU going deeper into Texas A&M territory. They're in plus territory for the first time tonight as we go under a minute to play here in the first quarter.
The big completion to Steven Nelson kind of unlocking some of this. You see the run game being opportunistic now.
Prescott line battles his way to the 25-yard line for another SMU first down. It's a gain of 8.
We talk about with Mark Snyder yesterday, you know, this is kind of a one-dimensional offense in SMU, and at the same time, when they start completing passes, it does open up the opportunity to run the football, forcing you to defend two phases.
Gilbert looking, throws, and it's over the head of Keenan Holman. And stops the clock with 26 seconds to go here in the first quarter. BCS Countdown presented by Discover Card. 6 o'clock Eastern, Monday, on ESPNU, also live on Watch ESPN. Number 4, Ohio State. Number 7, Louisville. Winning easily today. Big news, though, Jeff Driscoll, the starting quarterback for Florida, out for the year. Gilbert knocked down at the 20-yard line. Good play. It was intended for Jeremy Johnson, but Howard Matthews got a hand on it.
Well, that time, excellent protection by SMU up front. Gave Garrett Gilbert plenty of time to come all the way across the football field. Great defensive play, though, challenging that pass.
First really big test for this A&M defense.
It's still in a 3rd and 10. Can they continue to enjoy success on the third down?
Gilbert off his back foot, underthrown and tipped, and it lands incomplete. Tremaine Jacobs covering Holman. And it's 4th down.
Well, that time, Mark Snyder deciding to heat him up, bring the pressure from the perimeter. You see Tremaine Jacobs sticking with his coverage, though, eyes on Keenan Holman. Really 2 throws in a row where Garrett Gilbert had an opportunity to hit an open receiver. Ball wasn't where he would have liked. You see pressure getting there. Tony Hurd Jr. once again in and around the play that's being made.
Chase Hilbert. 6 for 7 with a long of 51 this year. This is a 42-yard attempt, and he splits the uprights. So SMU picks off Johnny Manziel. They march it into A&M territory and settle for 3.
You see A&M, they were starting to bleed yards just a little bit. Gaining some yards on the ground was SMU offensively. But it took a pressure there on 3rd down, and then an errant throw by Garrett Gilbert just over the head of an open receiver. You know, on the first 2 possessions for SMU, it was penalties. They had 2 penalties on both of those possessions that kind of undid what they were getting going offensively. They're able to piece together a drive, seize the momentum that an interception creates. They were denied the end zone, but still able to come away with points.
9 seconds to go here in the opening quarter.
Back in for the Aggies, number 1, Ben Molina, number 3, Trey Williams.
These fans in the rain last night, showed up for Yale practice. I mean, it was brutal here last night. It was cool and wet, and they still got almost 12,000 people to show up at midnight.
It's pretty amazing. How many fan bases actually practice being really good fans on game day? That's why it is the home of the 12th man. They take it seriously here.
Mike Loftus. And Trey Williams will bring it out to the 23-yard line. Let's check in on the number one team in the country. Let's go to the studio and Matt.
Thanks, Clay. A week after beating Texas A&M, Alabama, taking on Colorado State.
Fourth and
Kenyon
one.
Drake into the end zone. Of course, T.J. Yeldon suspended for the first quarter for the throat slash gesture last week. Alabama up 7-0, end of one.
Former Tide offensive coordinator Jim McElwain knows that Alabama defense, after having given up a ton of yards to Johnny Manziel, will be chomping at the bit this week. Speaking of Manziel, he gives it off to Brandon Williams, his first carry of the game. The Oklahoma transfer picks up nothing. In fact, a loss of one. And that's the end of the first quarter. Johnny Manziel, 6-for-8 already. Over 119 yards. Does have the interception. But his Aggies lead it 14-3.
Lone blemish being that turnover. Otherwise, it's been pretty spectacular by the quarterback of Texas A&M, Johnny Manziel, lighting them up again.
The story behind story. Tuesday.
From College Station, you're watching the SEC on ESPN. Johnny Manziel and Texas A&M looking for their fourth straight 40-point game. And they lead it 14-3. Here are statistics through one quarter.
SMU undid by penalties, but again, already a turnover, something that Summer learned to eliminate.
Went for Evans again. It's tipped and it's incomplete. You made this point earlier that Evans rarely lines up on the left side. He's usually on the right side of the formation.
From what I've seen this year, it's exclusive. Mike Evans stays on the right side. You see Manziel to Evans, it's a pretty strong connection. The completion percentage, 17 of 23. And every time he touches the football, 27 yards down the field.
And 2-for-2 on third down so far. Manziel on 3rd and 11. Cox and fires. Coming back, it's caught. That's Malcolm Kennedy. I'm going to say he was out. He was out of bounds. And it's fourth down. Kennedy had his foot on the line, said the line judge.
You see Kennedy, you can't believe it. But you see, as that right foot comes down, yeah, the toe right there on the white. That's a great shot. As he's completing that football, that's what would have established possession. As that right foot came down. And now, SMU, back-to-back stops. You know, previously, due to the interception by Hayden Greenbauer. And now, Malcolm Kennedy, a completed pass, but by inches, denied a conversion on third down.
Now, Drew Kayser.
First time out of the half, Texas A&M.
And the punting unit ready to go, but Texas A&M calls a timeout here. Just underway in the second quarter, Kevin Sumlin. And the Aggies leading 14-3.
A normal incandescent bulb uses about $7 worth of energy per year. This Cree LED bulb uses about $1. If you argue with math, you will lose.
The Cree LED bulb.
Once upon a time, an insurance clerk stumbled upon a cottage. No one was at home. But on the kitchen table sat three insurance policies. The first had lots of coverage. The second, only a little. But the third was
just right.
Hi. Yeah, we love visitors. That's why we moved to a secluded house in the middle of the wilderness.
Just the right coverage at just the right price. Coverage Checker from Progressive.
Don't settle for a slow computer. Just go to MyCleanPC.com to get your free computer diagnosis. Then activate the MyCleanPC.com software to speed up your computer. Get your free computer diagnosis at MyCleanPC.com.
Why should you try Instaflex for effective joint relief? Just ask former Pro Star quarterback Doug Flutie.
InstaFlex works for me, and it can work for you, too.
InstaFlex is available now at GNC, Walgreens, and these fine retailers.
ESPN On Demand has fresh content all September. ESPN Films takes you inside one of the most famous families in America with the debut of The Book of Manning. The best analysts in the game have you covered from the opening kick to triple zeros as college football makes its return. And Hispanic Heritage Month honors top athletes like Roberto Clemente, Fernando Valenzuela, and Julio Cesar Chavez. It's all this September on ESPN On Demand.
14-3, Texas A&M. After the timeout, Texas A&M punting unit out for the first time tonight. Drew Kaser has a big, strong leg, but just 7 punts in the first 3 weeks.
Got a big, fresh leg. He never has to use it.
Taylor, he returns, punts, two, calls for the fair catch at the 34-yard line. Johnny Manziel tonight, 119 yards passing. He has been picked off once. Also 35 on the ground and a touchdown.
Well, he picks his spots. He runs almost when he wants to because there's not a lot of pressure. He can deliver the football downfield, one of his favorite targets being Mike Evans. We started out hot in this ball game, 6 in a row. And the interception is kind of reminiscent of the one a week ago. He can't control the tipped ball. In fact, that one going off of Darrell Walker. But you see, starting out hot by Johnny Manziel and then cooling off, completed that previous pass to Malcolm Kennedy, but he was out of bounds.
There's a holding call on SMU on that punt. Back it up 10 yards. And the Mustangs will start at their own 25-yard line. Gilbert 10 of 16 for 67 yards. He's got all day. Crossing route complete. It's Jeremy Johnson as we go down to Don.
Yeah, guys, you know, Coach Sumlin had said before the game he wanted to see his defense get off the field on third down. This defense on the sideline, not very happy with what they've done so far here in this game. Defensive coordinator Mike Snyder telling his guys, you have to stay engaged in the ball game. Do a better job of it.
Thank you, Don. On second and one, it's Prescott Lyme. And he picks up the first down. Statistically, SMU, one of the worst defenses in the nation through the first 3 weeks. They gave up 6 long touchdown drives, 568 of total offense to the Tide. And we saw them bend on the last possession for SMU.
They gave up a first down there on the drive.
Lemke should have had it. Second down.
You can see heating it up, Steven Jenkins on the previous conversion. It was almost offside, but you see the ability of Prescott Lyme or any of these running backs for that matter to take advantage of when the defense starts to feel as if this is just passing all day long. We saw this on the previous drive by SMU. They can be effective on the ground. Zach Lyme, Prescott's brother, he tied or broke a couple of Eric Dickerson's record at SMU.
More laundry on the field, and this is going to go against the Mustangs.
False start. Number 75 of the offense. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
And this is the thing that June Jones just can't understand. This offense against Montana State missed opportunities, had way too many penalties, red zone turnovers. We're seeing a lot of mistakes here tonight.
Yeah, it's just a flinch, and that's all it takes. You know, these offensive linemen, defenders, they can move all they want. They can say whatever they want. If you twitch just a muscle, it's considered a false start. Chris Weeks already been flagged at his right tackle position 3 times.
And that's dropped. Jeremy Johnson can't handle it, and Jacobs was closing fast anyway. So now it's third and a mile. Texas, Kansas State, 8 Eastern on ABC, and Michigan, after almost getting upset by Akron last week, taking on UConn tonight, also on ABC.
And also, how do we get here? We get here off of 2 incompletions. You forfeit 5 yards, you need a false start, and now you're facing a 3rd and 10+. You know, you get behind schedule, and it compromises your play calling ability.
Gilbert has time to survey the field. That was tipped again and nearly picked off. That's their second ball batted down at the line by the Aggies. Nate Askew nearly came up with the interception, and it's fourth down for the Mustangs.
And so, you know, Don was talking about Mark Snyder was not very pleased defensively. The defender's not pleased. See, if the ball's going to come out quickly, if you're not going to get to the quarterback, get your arm up. That time, plenty of time.
Ben Molina scoops it up, and he'll get about 6 yards. 13:20 to go before halftime. Texas A&M leading 14-3. Johnny Football already over 100 yards passing.
Play.
All right, thanks, Matt. College Football Primetime presented by 5-Hour Energy from College Station. Now the last two possessions, an interception and a punt for Texas A&M. After scoring on their first two drives, here's Molina for a gain of 7. Let's go down to Don.
Guys, one thing I've noticed about Johnny Manziel, anytime something goes wrong on the field, he'll immediately come over after the possession, talk to his wide receivers, did it with Walker when he couldn't haul one in, and did it with Kennedy.
All right, thank you. Inside handoff. That's going to be close to a first down for A&M. Kevin Sumlin talked about the leadership of Johnny Manziel, especially after that loss, and we heard him actually talk post-game last week. He hasn't spoken a lot this year. He wanted to brag about his guys after that Alabama game, but we can't expect too much more of that this year. He doesn't want to talk to the media. Out to the 45. And that's a gain of 8. What do you think about Manziel essentially putting a moratorium on himself?
I don't care. I mean, look, what matters is what he does on the field, not what he says before or after a ball game, right?
Manziel gives it to Molina. And it's going to be close to moving the chains again. Yes, they will.
Four straight runs on the ground. You know, when we talk about, there's so much interest on Johnny Manziel. We think about it, a year ago, we didn't hear anything out of the guy.
Nope.
For 12 weeks, you heard nothing from Johnny Manziel. He played pretty good ball.
And another run. This time it's Trey Williams, and he gashes that Mustangs defense to the 36-yard line of SMU. Right behind Mike Matthews, the center. It's a 17-yard pickup. Wasting no time to get it in the hands of Nehemiah Hicks, the tight end. He'll pick up three more. Second down.
Well, there's a first completion we've seen from Manziel since the interception. One good way to get your offense going again, if your quarterback's cooling off a little bit, is once you establish the ground game. You know, you got the Maroon Goons, I think they call themselves, up front. I didn't say that. That's their name. Why not take advantage of that? There's a clear discrepancy between these two squads. A&M's got a distinct advantage in their offensive trenches.
And they're that good, they can call themselves whatever they want. Probably should have been caught. They may call pass interference here on Scott, the strong safety. It was intended for Malcolm Kennedy. John McDade. This officiating crew out of the American.
There's no foul for defensive pass interference. Third down.
Now they're going to pick up the flag.
It's not going to, the 12th man, they're going to like that. The collective 12th man here. You see Manziel delivering the football over the middle. I think that's a good no call. You know, the flag came out, which always causes more confusion than any of the officials would want. I think what they thought was that his hand was around the waist of the receiver. Kennedy looked like he was clean to make that catch.
Manziel. That's his first completion since he threw the interception. And it's a first down inside the 25-yard line. Sabian Holmes with the catch.
Nice clean pocket to work with. Once again, Johnny Manziel, only three rushers, so it should be. But look at all that space that he has to work with. Not only do you have a mobile passer who could deal with the pocket collapsing, but that doesn't happen very often with this front.
Fakes the throw, steps up, designed run. Slides into second base, close to another first down. You know, I don't doubt that he could play baseball, too.
He probably does. Just on the side, you know. There's probably some pro baseball scouts in the stands today.
It's a gain of 9 for Manziel. Pressure coming off the edge. Manziel sees it, eludes it, looking downfield, and throws it out of bounds.
Well, that's where, you know, he reminds me of Brett Favre when he does that. When he turns his back to the line of scrimmage. Well, that's something you'll hear quarterbacks, coaches, offensive coaches. They want their quarterback to always be facing downfield. Don't ever turn your back to the field of play. Favre did it all the time, and he enjoyed a pretty good career. And I think Johnny Manziel is a guy, you see him do that from time to time. This time it was a throwaway. A week ago, it was a Hail Mary completion.
11th play of the drive, caught. Kennedy up the line, touchdown. And a great block by Mike Evans. 16-yard connection. Kennedy from Manziel. First touchdown pass of the night for Johnny. 11 plays, 74 yards. Bertolat missed the extra point.
One is no good.
And it's 20-3. You said it before, Mike Evans does more than just catch footballs. He can block, too.
Yeah, he comes in handy. They put that to use, too. Look at number 13 blocking out wide. Ends up with the defender on the ground. Malcolm Kennedy able to get to the end zone clean. Those receivers, they catch balls. They also block out wide.
College Football Daily, weekdays at 1 on ESPNU.
ESPNU College Football Primetime is brought to you by GMC. Introducing the all-new 2014 GMC Sierra. Incredible thinking in the form of a truck. And Buffalo Wild Wings, the official hangout for NCAA football.
Now that's the way I'd like to train, on the beach in San Diego. Johnny Manziel working with the quarterback guru, George Whitfield, this past offseason. Manziel tonight, a touchdown passing and a touchdown rushing. It's 20-3 now. The number 10 team in the country leading SMU. Taylor Bertolet was recovered an onside kick already here tonight. Has it on the tee again. There's Jabryce Taylor, the true freshman return man, back deep for SMU. Now they're going to get somebody out to hold it. There's just enough wind swirling down on the field. The ball's already been knocked off a couple of times.
Well, here at Kyle Field, it's open on one end. It's pretty much enclosed on the other. Somehow allows that wind to get down there on the field. Wreaks havoc on a couple of kickoffs.
They're renovating the stadium. That'll be closed in by the 2015 season. From the 4-yard line, it's Taylor looking for room on the outside, and he is hammered down at the 22-yard line. He worked with George Whitfield, the quarterback's guru, this past offseason and the season before, but you'd never know it. A lot of the criticism of Manziel this past offseason that he was too busy going to concerts and frat parties, but he was getting some work done.
It came ridiculous at the end of this offseason, where it's as if, you know, if the kid showed up for class and he forgot to brush his teeth, it's national news, and they forget the fact that he did work on his craft, and we've seen it borne out on the field of play. Well, other than the NCAA issues, there's nothing else to talk about.
Gilbert has a man open, but Jeremy Johnson can't haul it in. He was falling down. There's some pretty good chemistry between Gilbert and Johnson. They can't bring it home here at 2nd and 10.
Yeah, but going back to Manziel and the lightning rod that he became after an unbelievable freshman campaign culminating in the Heisman Trophy, and then everything became scrutinized. Are we surprised that he got thrown out of a fraternity party at the University of Texas? I, for one, am not, and don't think it's that big of a deal. But working on your craft on the beach in San Diego or wherever, that accumulates to performance on the field. And we've seen it, I think, in the first 3 or 4 games this year.
Out of the 2-back set, Prescott Line takes it ahead. Nate Askew makes the tackle. It's a short gain of a couple yards. And so now a third and fairly long here.
You know, SMU is going to have to change up their snap count. You see it here, Steven Jenkins, he's timed it up just right a couple of times already. Because it's loud, it's difficult to operate. You're in the shotgun a lot. If you don't change up the timing of that snap, the defensive front seven can start timing up their rush, and they'll be into the line of scrimmage.
Third and seven, pressure off the backside by Askew. Gilbert gets away once, spins out of another tackle, but Askew cleans him up at the 21-yard line. It's a loss of four. And this defense gets off the field on third down for the fifth time tonight. Mark Snyder has to be pleased.
Well, they only got six third downs a week ago. I misspoke a down ago. It's Askew on both instances doing a good job of timing up his pressure and getting in the backfield.
Fourth punt for SMU, backing off and hauling it in at the 20. Harris to midfield. Actually, Molina. No, that is Harris. Duplicate numbers. Molina wears number one as well. Coming up, a family tree unlike any in football. The Matthews family. We'll talk about it next. Center of your screen, the Matthews brothers, Jake and Mike. Come from a great football family, and it all goes back to Clay Matthews Sr., an NFL offensive lineman back in the early 50s. His son, Clay Jr., turned into a great NFL linebacker, and his sons, all defensive players. Clay Matthews III, Casey Matthews, and Kyle. And then Bruce Matthews, the other son of Clay Sr., an NFL offensive lineman, in fact, a Hall of Famer. His three sons, all with A&M connections, Kevin, Jake, and Mike.
It runs in the blood, doesn't it?
It sure does.
I mean, and could it come from a better bloodline? You see him there, the center for Texas A&M, Mike Matthews, and then what is likely to be the top offensive lineman taken in this next NFL draft, Jake Matthews, at left tackle. Excellent football players, and no surprise given those genetics.
Man wide open. That's Kennedy. And that's a gain of 21.
Well, the game just, it looks like it comes so easily to Jake Matthews. The patience, the outstanding balance. You can climb up to the second level. Just a good technician. And really watching film of him versus Alabama and then here tonight, hard to find a minus play where he could have done a better job.
Trey Carson stumbling, stays on his feet. There's a flag down, but what an impressive run by Trey Carson, the sophomore.
Number 56 offense, 10-yard penalty, first down.
But his 16-yard gain will be wiped out. That's on Mike.
We talk about Mike Matthews. He's got a couple of penalties tonight with a snap infraction, starting at the center position right there in the middle of the offensive line. And when the defensive lineman starts to disengage, it looks like a hold. And with the offensive line coaches, B.J. Anderson, here at Texas A&M, we want you to continue to run your feet. That time ends up with a holding penalty.
So first and 20, Manziel trying to get a chunk of it back and does. Kennedy hops out of bounds a yard short of the first down. Kennedy now, a 20-yard pickup there. He's got five catches for 70 yards.
Once again, just it's all day to work, and you have to decide, what are you going to do? You want to try to blitz Johnny Manziel? If you rush three, it's hard to get around guys as talented as Jake Matthews. And let's not forget Cedric Oboye on the other side of the right tackle position.
They think Oboye will move to left tackle next year after Matthews goes. Manziel dives to the 10. It's going to bring up second down and manageable. Of course, Jake and Mike playing together for the first time in their careers. And you played with your brother.
Yeah, he was there. We never got on the field at the same time. He got redshirted my senior year when I was playing left tackle. Ended up going to have a pretty good career of his own. But you can see the bloodline just keeps refilling here at A&M.
Incomplete. Penalty flag that was intended for Walker. Parks may have interfered.
You know, Clay, on that previous play, that's an element of this offense. with the design QB run.
Pass interference, number one of the defense. Penalty result in an automatic first down.
That they didn't have in this offense really at Houston. You see here with Jake Matthews, just locking guys down at the line of scrimmage. Nobody in his face. That ball just sails on Manziel. Regardless, draws the interference penalty.
Your brother John has bragging rights over you, too. He's got a Super Bowl ring. This play is whistled dead, and that might be against Effetti.
False start. Number 74 of the offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Yeah, the rookie jumped.
Just a little bit early. You got to hold your water. He's going to pop around on a pull, and he just starts early from his right guard position. You could see him starting to lean back in his stance. I played a little guard as well. Whenever you know you have to pull, you get down there towards the red zone, things happen quicker. You want to make sure you get around and lead your running back up into the line of scrimmage. That time, Effetti just a little early.
Manziel keeps. There's his second touchdown run of the night. From 7 yards out, it's Johnny Manziel, his third total touchdown of the evening.
We get them to the perimeter clean, another design QB run. Well, even if you're not blocking for Johnny Manziel on a run, he can make things happen. You can only imagine when it's intentional.
He missed again. Second extra point miss by Taylor Bertolette.
Well, maybe we shouldn't have bragged on him so much on that onside kick. Did a great job with the onside kick, having difficulties with point after.
Manziel accounted for all 49 yards on that touchdown drive, and Effetti throwing a nice block to get Manziel home.
Matchick back in the studio. Coming up at halftime, Florida gets a win on the field but suffers a big loss with a season-ending injury to quarterback Jeff Driscoll. We'll show you what happened there. We'll update you on Auburn and LSU and take you around the top 25. We will see you at halftime.
All right, Matt. 7-11 before halftime. Johnny Manziel with his third touchdown accounted for tonight, a 7-yard run. Matt talked briefly there about Auburn, LSU. Big game tonight in the SEC for both of those teams, both 3-0. We've seen both. How do you think that turns out tonight?
I think it's going to be a real challenge for the Auburn secondary. Well, front seven as well, but as balanced as LSU has become and as adept as they've become with their vertical passing game, and Cam Cameron, their new role coordinator, he's got Zach Mettenberger bombing away on defenses so far this season.
Jabryce Taylor. And he doesn't even get to the 20 this time. Long field for SMU. Look at our SEC greats brought to you by Regions Bank. And it's Luke Jokel, a Texas A&M star the last few years, an All-American, won the Outland Trophy. First team All-SEC, the number 2 overall pick by the Jags in April's draft. And our next stop on the Regions Bank SEC Greats Tour, September 28th in Fayetteville, Arkansas. And there is the guy who took a spot.
Yeah, he's next. I mean, it's just, you know, next up, you lose Luke Jokel. And, you know, I don't know. I mean, how much did they lose in losing Luke Jokel? You lose the number 2 overall pick. Shocked that he didn't go number 1, really, as adept as he was. And then what you do, you just replace him with a guy who I think might be as good. And you talk to the coaches, and they say Cedric Abuehi, he might be better than both of them, both Luke Jokel and Matthews.
Now, there was a holding call on the return against SMU, so they back it up even further inside the 10-yard line. It's been a tough night for this offense. Gilbert. Complete. Ball pops out. Scooped up. Touchdown, Texas A&M. DeShazer Everett takes it 12 yards to the house. Jeremiah Gaines, the true freshman with a rookie mistake, had it and lost it.
Bad night, a tough night, gets a lot tougher. You know, really, it was a bang-bang play. You know, who forces it? It was Tony Hurd Jr. again. You know, it was an incomplete pass, and the last time it seemed like he popped the ball out. Let's keep an eye on this point after. It's proven to be an adventure the last couple of tries.
And it continues to be an odyssey. That was Josh Lambeau, number 49, coming in to kick. And he doesn't prove any more effective. Now the snap comes out of Jake Matthews, and the hold by Kaiser, the punter, is fumble.
Well, the snap was fine. Might have been a little bit high. And Kaiser just doesn't get the ball down. We were taking a look at the previous two misses. It didn't look like the hold was the issue. That time, though, it was just a bad hold. That Tony Hurd, you know, Tony did that earlier. You know, we've got his head right on the football, and it popped out there. Jeremiah Gaines, he sees it. He bobbles it initially. He's running before he catches it. You see DeShazer Everett coming up from his safety position. Well, it's interesting. You talk about these heady football players. A lot of times in recruiting, you talk about skill sets and 40 times. Mark Snyder said on Tony Hurd, you know, this guy gives up a little bit in the physical areas, but he's a heady football player. He's a veteran. And already tonight, he's made plays for an A&M defense that needs playmakers to step up.
And Bertolette with the kickoff. Taylor from the goal line. Hit hard at the 15. Ain't gonna get any more. Good coverage by Texas A&M. Coverage of college football continuing later tonight on ESPNU. The Wyoming Cowboys taking on the Air Force Falcons. College football primetime. Wyoming Air Force 10:15 ESPNU, also live on Watch ESPN. Dave Christensen, Troy Calhoun, the two coaches for Wyoming and Air Force respectively. Heated exchange after that game last year. We'll see what happens here tonight on ESPNU. .32-3 Texas A&M. Garrett Gilbert, a transfer from Texas, out of the gun. Incomplete. Penalty flag. Holyfield, the intended penalty receiver.
Number 64 of the offense. Penalty half the distance to goal line. First down.
That's the left guard, Sam Rice.
And what Sam Rice is doing is he's popping out to try to help. Bringing edge pressure by A&M. In the second quarter, where A&M really got things rolling, and it started with the run game. You know, we could tell that they were intentional with what they were trying to get done with the ground, and it showed, and it ended up opening up the passing yardage the previous touchdown drive.
10th penalty, backs SMU inside their own 10. Line with the catch out of the backfield. No release real estate on that far sideline. Gain of just one as Tony Hurd Jr. steps up again to make the tackle. You know, the coaching staff told us yesterday that Hurd Jr. at 5'9", 185, makes up for the fact that he's small with his smarts.
Yeah, he cheats a little bit. You know, he feels what the offense is trying to do and gains ground with his brain. And he'll start rolling to where the play is. Tremaine Jacobs makes this play. He's more physically gifted than a Tony Hurd Jr. You see him fight through the block like that? You see these guys, if they're going to come up and make a play, they're able to do that all night tonight. The horizontal passing game, not able to open up things downfield.
SMU just 2 of 7 tonight on third down. A&M has done a great job getting off the field. Keenan Holman trying to outrun the defenders. Can't cut the corner. Hurd escorts him out. It's a gain of 12, but it's going to be fourth down for SMU. They have to punt.
Once again, you start a series off, get a penalty, you're behind in the down and distance. Now you're just trying to get back to where you started on the drive. June Jones all night long, it seems, other than one drive in the first quarter where they've had a clean series with no penalties. Otherwise, it's been marred with miscues.
Devontae Harris slipped at the 43-yard line. 44-yard punt, 6-yard return. ESPNU's exclusive coverage of women's college soccer continuing tomorrow. Top 25 matchup, number 2 Stanford, number 2 22 Santa Clara. 10 Eastern on ESPNU. Also live on Watch ESPN. All right, so here's Johnny Manziel coming back out. 187 passing, 59 rushing, 3 total touchdowns. He has been intercepted once. 5:14 before half. Manziel, time to throw. Now going to improvise. On the run. Coming back and making the catch. That was Laquiviante Gonzalez. Another true freshman. And it's a 21-yard play.
That's a great play. It's an athletic play. Throwing, rolling to your left and throwing with a right arm quarterback. I don't know what he was doing, though. I mean, when you look at it, he had all day in the world. The pocket
on the field is a catch at the sideline. This play is now under review.
We're going to look at it and see if Gonzalez kept a foot in bounds.
You see Manziel delivering it. It's the same sideline. He's got both of them in, unless they're thinking he's juggling it. Looks like he's got the ball trapped against his face mask. I wonder if the ball made contact with the ground before he completes the catch. You see the tip of the ball hanging out? I don't think he has it. You know, it looks to me like before he convincingly maintains control of this football, that it makes contact with the ground. You see the tip of the ball kind of hanging out. And as he goes down, there's probably a better look at it.
Doyle Jackson from the American Conference, our replay official tonight.
You know, earlier they had a completed pass, a third down to Malcolm Kennedy. Clearly the foot was out of bounds, same sideline. Here, you know, it has to be indisputable video evidence for them to say, look, the ruling on the field was a catch. It's obvious to us up here in the booth that it was something.
Taking a long look at it upstairs. Cluviante Gonzalez is credited with the catch. They're looking at it. The number 12 athlete on the ESPN 300 last year out of Cedar Hill, Texas.
We're taking a look at maybe the number 1 athlete that's already in college in Johnny Manziel. There's a whole lot of conversation given that, you know, it looks to me like there's 2 pretty good looks at it. I'd be surprised if it's not ruled incomplete. Frankly, it looked to me like the ground made contact before he completed the catch. You know, usually you'll see, you know, the receiver's hand or arm will be underneath the ball, but it looked to me like the ground, if anything, aided him in maintaining control of it.
Defensive scores from around the Southeastern Conference this evening.
Well, this is no fun.
Well, it might be exchange, really, potato salad recipes at this, but I don't know what else there is to talk about.
After video review, it is an incomplete pass. The receiver's bobbling the ball, and the ball hits the ground without it being controlled. The ball will be placed at the 41-yard line, the previous spot, where it'll be 2nd and 10.
But, you know, going back to that play, even before it came to this, it's kind of curious. When you watch this offensive front, SMU's only going to bring 3. There's no pressure here. You could stand in this pocket all day. Look at this. There's nothing collapsing about this pocket, really. And yet, for whatever reason, Manziel flushes. You know, he gets away with this because he's good at it, but there's no reason to leave the pocket there.
Brandon Williams on 2nd down will pick up 4. Williams has A&M fans excited about his possibilities as a home run threat. He'll come out here, and it's third down with 4:42 to go. Inside the pocket, outside the pocket. The numbers for Manziel clearly doing a lot inside that pocket you were talking about.
And incidentally, he's doing better and operating more from the pocket slightly this season, but more so than a year ago.
He'll step out of the pocket here, and he's going to be hit and dropped short of midfield, about 2 yards short of the first down. Bo Barnes and Kevin Pope, who's been spying Manziel tonight, combine on the tackle. Fourth down.
Well, that time, Pope does a good enough job to keep him in front.
And they're going to go for it.
You know, in meeting with Coach Sumlin yesterday, well, this is their mentality. This is something that they adhere to. They're going to be aggressive. Onside kicks, going for it on fourth down.
It's Williams. And he muscles his way into SMU territory for the first down. A gain of three. They'll move the chains with 3:48 to go before half.
And part of that is a vote of confidence in his defense here tonight. The defense that really has asserted itself in a lot of ways, done an excellent job of neutralizing SMU's offense.
Keep it on the ground. Williams again. Bouncing to the outside. First down and more inside the 35-yard line and wrestled out by Derek Longoria. It's a gain of 16. How about this stiff arm?
That's a good way to keep a defender off of you. Well, there's an opportunity. Could have been a tackle for loss with the penetration.
Manziel running a little option play. He'll keep it. Cut it up. And another penalty flag down.
Legal substitution on the defense. The 12th player did not get off the field in time. This is a 5-yard penalty. First down.
That's the 11th penalty against SMU this half.
It's got to be frustrating for these coaches. And, you know, when you look at it, guys, you've got to hustle all the way off the football field. To me, like, maybe the substitution got in late. Either way, you know, A&M, they run their offense as quickly as SMU does, and typically they've done it year over year. SMU has just now stepped up their pace. They're ready to snap the ball at 13 seconds.
Manziel slings it for a first down. Caught at the 15 by Malcolm Kennedy.
It seems as if, and they've had other passes, other targeted receivers. They've just enjoyed more success throwing it to Evans. But here tonight, you see Manziel moving away from number 13, their star receiver, getting Malcolm Kennedy, and saving holds with a couple of touches involved.
Manziel now to 200 passing. We're not even to halftime. And he'll run this one into the end zone. Touchdown. A penalty flag comes in late at the end of that play.
Holding. Number 11 the offense. 10-yard penalty. First down.
Darrell Walker, the wide receiver, called for the hold.
Well, we talk about these receivers, you know, how they do an excellent job being physical when the ball's in the air, but also as blockers on the perimeter. Darrell Walker had a tip ball, ended up being intercepted earlier. You see him, you know, he's running a route. Johnny, man, this is a pass. And this is what these receivers do an excellent job of. You see him kind of peeking, and he sees Manziel's running. He just throws the defender on the ground. That's definitely a hold. Obviously, easy call for the official.
Manziel sprinting out, pitches it out to Williams. Ball comes loose for a while. Williams recovers. That's going to be a loss of two on the play. Jay Scott, the strong safety there, to make the play defensively.
We saw an option look two plays ago. Manziel kept it here. I don't know if Williams was ready for the ball. Either way, it looked like a fine enough pitch and let him. We saw him versus Alabama. What was interesting, they ran the option to the left, an option look, and Manziel flipped it with his right hand rather than pitching it with his left.
Kevin Pope is the man down, the senior middle linebacker for SMU. And this defense, without him, will be in even more trouble. It's already been spotty this year, allowing an average of 36 points and 420 yards per game through the first 2 weeks. It's been a tough night already tonight.
you'll see him. He's coming into your screen. We talked about him tonight. He made a big stop on third down. It's kind of strange. I don't know if it was due to the contact of Mike Evans. Now, the way they're attended to him, it doesn't look like it was a lower body injury. I don't know if he got his bell rung a little bit. Good to see him up and walking off the field under his own power. And he came up and made a big stop that forced the fourth down attempt by A&M earlier in this drive. Obviously, they converted it. He'll have to leave the field for at least one snap. But it looks to me like he's prepared to come right back into the lineup.
Ninth play of this drive for Texas A&M. It's second down and 12. Ball at the 16-yard line of SMU. Manziel, the comebacker. Evans inside the 5-yard line. He has become Manziel's favorite target over the last 2 years. He has at least 4 catches in every game of his career. Now 2 for 57 tonight.
Such a physical guy. You know, you get the ball to him with blockers out in front, like on a tunnel screen. It's difficult to wrestle him to the ground, as big as he is.
They need a yard. Carson. Kevin Pope back in, made the tackle. Going to be short. Didn't get it.
That's 2 fourth downs that Kevin Pope has stepped up big and forced a fourth down attempt. A&M going for it again.
It looked like somebody jumped on that right side of the A&M line.
Illegal snap. Number 56 of the offense. 5-yard penalty. Fourth down.
That's the second illegal snap on Matthews.
You get down in the red zone. And I don't know if it was they were trying to get over the ball and run a quarterback sneak. Sometimes that's what you'll do. If it's a fourth down attempt or if it's a few inches, you see Johnny Manziel's disappointed. He wants to go for the end zone regardless of the 5 yards. Field goal kicking, place kicking here tonight, has it not been an automatic, regardless of the yardage?
Well, Josh Lambeau coming in for the second time. Taylor Bertolette didn't work out. We'll see if Lambeau can get it done from 28 yards out. Good. But there is a flag down. Man, this has been a penalized
offside.
First half.
Number 84 of the defense. Pays half the distance to the goal line, fourth down.
Now will he go for it? You get your 5 yards back.
Manziel will come on out. He's going to get his chance after all.
That's one way of getting it, right? Send out the field goal unit to draw him offsides. That's not the way they had it drawn up. Mike Matthews gets to make amends from another illegal procedure with that simulated snap. He must be hitching the ball a little bit. Manziel gets his wish.
They need a yard. Is that a trick play that went awry? Nehemiah Hicks comes up with it, and he's tackled. And A&M will turn it over on downs.
Look at Kevin Sumlin. He's hot, and rightfully so. You get a bad snap that backs you up for a field goal attempt. Then you get a gift, another chance at it. He wants to talk with the center, Mike Matthews. I don't know if they were trying to go for a direct snap to Nehemiah Hicks as he came in motion. It looked like that might have been the case. You see him in. I think Mike Matthews, he snapped it. I think he thought that Manziel was under center. I don't know if he wasn't paying attention. And usually he can feel it.
So a red zone blunder. And SMU goes back to work with a minute left before halftime. Holman the catch out close to the 15.
Yeah, Just a bad snap. Like he hung on to the ball a little bit too long. That snap hand's got, he's got a glove on. I don't know, maybe it's a tacky glove.
First down catch. Jeremy Johnson will move the chain, steps out with 38 seconds to go before halftime. SMU has all of its timeouts left.
See B.J. Anderson, offensive line coach for A&M. He's talking with his center. For whatever reason, you know, Mike Matthews, a vocal leader for that front, but he's had difficulties here tonight just with the center quarterback exchange.
And the kicking game has been less than impressive. That lands incomplete. Just 3 seconds elapse off the clock. Johnson, the intended receiver.
Well, something to consider, you know, when you look at the field position now, is it's not only are you trying to get the ball downfield, maybe try to get into scoring position, but also you don't want to run the play so quickly that you have to punt it back and give an A&M another shot.
Gilbert, quick strike. Coleman slips out of one tackle and is stopped near the 30. And it's Tremaine Jacobs. And a timeout call by SMU. First down and 10 with 28 seconds to go. Quest for the Coach's Trophy presented by Dr. Pepper and Kevin Sumlin, the SEC Coach of the Year last year. Deserves a lot of credit for keeping things under control this offseason with that whole Manziel investigation going on. What he has done in a short time at this program is spectacular.
Look at those offensive numbers. Top three in total offense for the last five seasons. Obviously, that overlaps into his time at Houston here in the state of Texas. But they didn't miss a beat. You know, here you are, you come to A&M, a new program. You got a new quarterback, doesn't have any college snaps. Oh, and by the way, you're in the most competitive conference in college football for the first season. What do? You win 11 ball games. And the two you drop are to LSU and Florida.
Beat Alabama, won the Cotton Bowl, and got the Heisman Trophy to boot. Pretty good year one.
This is our inaugural season. Couldn't go any better.
Gilbert to Prescott line out of the backfield, and A&M runs him out. Oh, they're going to keep the clock going, but SMU will stop it with a timeout. They've got one left. So 19 seconds to go. SMU has one timeout remaining. Women's college soccer tomorrow. The SEC Network launching August 2014. Most powerful conference of college sports. We'll live on a new network. Tradition has found a new home. You know, hard to argue with that statement as the most powerful conference of college sports are going for their 8th national title in college football. News and notes. Jeff Driskel out for the season with a broken ankle, the quarterback at Florida. Aaron Murray, 22 of 30 for 400-plus yards and 3 touchdowns today against North Texas. Was close for a while. And Zach Mettenberger and LSU leading Auburn 21-0. We'll have more highlights for you coming up at the half. That's dropped. Steven Nelson can't come up with it. Third down. 14 seconds to go.
Well, you look at Florida. We're going down with Jeff Driskel. That changes what they're going to do offensively. They're trying to come up with answers. And here tonight, you see two very quarterback-centric offenses. Florida obviously differently in that regard. Easily the most important position on the field, no matter what your offense is.
Second charge timeout of the half, Texas A&M.
So Texas A&M calling a timeout here. Kevin Sumlin. His team leading 32-3 just before halftime. Coming up later tonight, the Holy War, Utah and BYU on ESPN2. Wyoming and Air Force on ESPNU. What a great game in the Mountain West last night on ESPN. Fresno State and Boise. It was a 1-point win for Fresno.
Well, Fresno State might be unseating Boise State. You know, before Boise State became the Cinderella team, it was Fresno State that was kind of the team running around busting BCS teams before the Fiesta Bowl victory by the Broncos, and it might be returning to form when Fresno State Bulldogs are the banner bearer for that conference.
They're going to a prevent defense out of the timeout. Goes Texas A&M. Gilbert pressured, hit as he throws. It's caught at the 49, and they're going to rule him down. Darius Joseph with the catch. 9 seconds to go as June Jones calls his last timeout. Boy, Gilbert got rid of that just in the nick of time.
Stood in with the pressure bearing down on him and able to deliver the football to midfield. Give yourself a chance at the end zone. You won't see it coming in until late. This time it's Steven Jenkins coming around. Watch him. He knows he's going to get hit. He's able to deliver the football. Joseph couldn't get out of bounds because he's got his knees down just to make the completion. He had a timeout to give.
Garrett Gilbert started for the Texas Longhorns as a sophomore in 2010, but had a tough year. Threw 17 interceptions, just 10 touchdowns. Got a medical redshirt the next year after injuring his shoulder. Decided he needed a change of scenery, and he ends up at SMU playing for June Jones.
And you can see him, you know, it's a totally different offense for him as he transitioned away from Texas. But he grew into it toward the back end of last season. You can expect him to just go for the big bend, just hang one up there high. The three wide receivers at the bottom of your screen.
There's some confusion down on the field.
Substitution infraction on the defense. 12 men in formation. 5-yard penalty, first down.
Well, this is the home of the 12th man, but you can't have literally 12 players on the field at one time.
At Kyle Field, the 12th man's in the stands. He's not supposed to be on the field, obviously. And Mark Snyder, you see him there, defensive coordinator. When you're coming out of a timeout, you're coaching up your guys, and all of a sudden you got an extra on the field. That wasn't due to tempo. They had plenty of time.
Gilbert unloads, caught at the 30, stepping out of bounds. Darius Joseph. Clock stops with 4 seconds to go. And I'm going to bring that field goal unit up. Chase Hover, a career-long 52 last year at Tulane. He's got a strong leg. His long of this season is 51. This is only from 47 just before half. And they're going to ice him. A&M burning its last timeout.
Charge timeout of the half, Texas A&M. It will be a 30-second timeout.
Well, here I am. I'm talking about how they're going to go for the end zone. It's going to burn up this clock just to get the receivers down into position to run a tip drill in the end zone. June Jones is saying, no. I just got to get into field goal range. Let's get a completion and run our field goal unit out there. And as you mentioned, this is a makeable distance.
Hover hit from 42 earlier tonight. There have been 21 total penalties in this first half.
The bulk of those coming on SMU, and the scoring opportunities have been few and far between for the Mustangs.
That's why they'd like to cash in here just before halftime, take a little momentum into the locker room. Hover from 47. Looks good. Bang! Chase Hover. Putting 3 points on the board just before halftime, but yet another flag. Hold everything. My goodness.
The officiating crew, maybe that's why they took so long on the video review. They needed to catch their breath from all the throwing of flags and recuperate those arms.
Those points are going to count.
Kevin Sumlin wondering what happened.
That's the end of the first half.
Personal foul. Number 42 of the defense. Penalties decline. The field goal is good. That is the end of the first half.
SMU with a 9-play, 61-yard drive to end the first half. 47-yard field goal by Hover. It's 32-6 at the break. And Texas A&M will have the football to start the second half. The defense for Texas A&M, pretty impressive. That was the area they most needed to improve on here tonight.
Yeah, much better. They started this game off hot on third down, getting SMU off of the football field. Maybe the lone blemish was the two-minute drill that we just witnessed, where you see just enough yardage and keep SMU out of the end zone, but you end up giving up the 3 points when there was a field to defend. It wasn't like they started with great field position.
Let's go down to Don.
Coach, just saw you talking to the officials. What were you talking to them about?
I can't talk about it right now.
Okay, you look at your defense. You told me before the game you wanted to see them improve. How can you assess their performance that first half?
Some good, some bad. You know, just hard to get momentum with the stoppages. You know, we got penalties everywhere. We got more penalties right now than we've had all year. You know, it's just hard to get any kind of continuity. The defense is playing well. You know, got us a turnover, scored. You know, we just got to get some continuity and eliminate some of these mistakes.
Coach Sumlin, I appreciate it. Thanks.
Johnny Manziel, 212 yards passing and a touchdown, 75 rushing and two touchdowns, 32-6 A&M. Let's go to the studio for the halftime report. Here's Matt.
Thank you, Clay. 32-6, Texas A&M with the halftime lead over SMU. Matt Schickelon with Charles R.
Welcome back to ESPNU College Football, presented by 5-Hour Energy. Welcome back to the SEC on ESPN. Choppy, sloppy first half of football, but A&M is in control after that 49-42 loss last week to number one Alabama. It's 32-6 at the half here. Their game against SMU. Matt Stinchcomb, Clay Matthick back upstairs here at Kyle Field. And they have responded pretty well after the emotionally draining defeat last week. And Johnny Manziel, over 200 yards passing already tonight, 75 yards rushing, 3 total touchdowns. Been impressed with his pocket that he's been able to work from.
He's got plenty of time on virtually all of his drop back passes. You see here, it's not just a function of the protection. You know, a lot of times you think the reason he doesn't get sacked is because he's mobile. It's because he's afforded the time to deliver the football. A lot of three-man rushes, but even still, at this play here, where it's incredibly wide pocket, he flushes because I guess he wants to flush. He wants to throw on the run. But it's not like he's getting forced out of the pocket. This offensive line does an excellent job of providing their quarterback time to operate.
First half stats brought to you by John Deere. Look at the penalties down there. 21 total in the first half. 12 against SMU. And that was a two-hour first half. Johnny Football, go to work right away. A&M will start with it. From a yard deep, Trey Williams gets out over the 20. And we go down to Don Davenport.
SMU coach June Jones said, honestly, there's not a whole lot that they can do to help contain Johnny Manziel, but he did tell me that they are giving him way too much time. They've got to get to him a little bit faster, put some pressure on him so he can't make all these plays.
It's been a common problem for coaches over the last year plus.
And that's the kind of the game theory for these coaches coming in is, do you pressure him or do you not? And if you do pressure him, you expose yourself to scrambles. You see some of the numbers that he's been able to put up. Pretty proficient passing. He was 0 for 4 for a stretch, but got right back on the horse.
Trey Williams, a sophomore who's been nicked up a little bit this year with an ankle injury. Getting some early work here in the second half. Johnny Manziel went off for 294 passing and 124 rushing last year against SMU. as Williams gets it again. It was a 48-3 blowout win for Texas A&M against the Mustangs last year. It was the first win for Manziel as the starting quarterback. The week before, they had lost to Florida.
Yeah, you think about it, and it was a delayed season even with that. They were supposed to play Louisiana Tech prior to the Florida game.
Facing a third down on their first series of the second half, Manziel has a lane to run. He's got the first down and steps out at the 35. A 7-yard pickup for Manziel.
You know, and visiting with Tom Mason, the defensive coordinator for SMU, just going back to what Don was sharing, you got to figure out what are you willing to do versus this offense. And if you want to pressure Manziel, do you really want him escaping the pocket? Is that the desired outcome? Because he can hurt you there too.
Another long opportunity, and Manziel connects with Walker. Darrell Walker inside the 35 to the 33-yard line.
A three-man rush, and this time, watch Pope in the middle of your screen. He's just going to try to run underneath this route. Really, they broke off coverage. Robert Seals just shut it down.
And go back to Molina on the ground. So after the 32-yard play, they'll pick up 7 on first down here, second down.
You know, from what we've seen tonight, Clay, it's almost as if you're better off at least bringing 4 rushers. You know, 3, this offensive line can more than likely handle the blitz anyway, but give yourself a fighting chance, because if not, you've got adept receivers running in your secondary.
Manziel checks.
You can see SMU, they were showing some edge pressure. Looks to me like he's checking to a different protection scheme to pick it up.
Slipping around the tackle and pressure on Manziel. But he picks up the first down and more. That is quintessential Johnny football right there.
I tell you what, I mean, well, we just talked about it. You can't get there with the three-man rush. SMU tips their hand a little bit. Stephon Sanders showing the edge pressure. Still Cedric Oboye unable to get over there to him. But how many times have we seen defenders diving and nipping at the heels of Johnny Manziel and just cannot get enough of them to get him on the ground?
Here they are in the red zone, 7th play of the drive. Molina spinning to the doorstep, stopped at the 1. Second down and goal.
Ben Molina, he's been kind of quiet. You know, it's been a lot of Trey Williams, it seems. Well, at the beginning of the second quarter, you could see A&M going to the run game more. It's been largely Trey Williams contributing on the ground.
Molina's going to get it again on the pitch. And he sashays in for the touchdown. Jake Williams, Jake Matthews, another nice block. And Matthews will take those gloves off quickly so he can snap on the PAT.
Well, it seems to me like on PATs, that's about the only part that's gone well so far. The snap seems to be getting delivered fine. Keep an eye on the hold and the kick.
And it's Lambeau. And he got it. A Bronx cheer from the crowd here. A made extra point. It's 39-6. And if it weren't for the missed extra points earlier in this game, Texas A&M would already have more than 40 points. Manziel key on this opening drive of the second half.
Should come as no surprise that the most electrifying quarterback in college football, getting it done with the passes downfield, but also deciding to leave the pocket, pick up yards downfield, and then adjust the play to go to the option, gets it to Ben Molina to get in for the score.
Cora Cadets here at A&M as you're watching the SEC on ESPN. That scoring drive for Texas A&M 8 plays, 77 yards in 3:26. That's her longest scoring drive tonight, time-wise. Everything else has come very quickly. 2:51 or less. A couple under 2 minutes.
The three-and-a-half marathon drive, huh? 3.5 minutes.
Bertolette with the touchback. Jake Matthews, one of the rare guys that not only starts on the line but also snaps. Here is a great play that shows you what he can do off that left tackle spot.
Yeah, there he is at left tackle. They check to an option, and he goes in, out, and up. They're pitching off the defensive end, and he gets up on Kevin Pope. And then, you know, look, he goes from protecting the passer to becoming the passer. You got to go there, drop my hands. It's kind of like a quarterback. He's just a big, oversized quarterback. And then check out the spiral. Throws a strike. Still barely sneaks into the uprights.
It's been that kind of night for the Kickers. Garrett Gilbert sets and throws. Joseph the catch. Only gets a couple of yards. You know, Bruce Matthews, his dad, the Hall of Famer, told Jake, he said, hey, you know, if you can long snap, deep snap, you can play a long time in the NFL. I think Jake will play a long time in the NFL without that specialty, but that doesn't hurt either.
No, it's the more you can do. That's a locker room mantra. The more you can do, the more valuable you are. You know, Bruce Matthews, one of the finest offensive linemen ever played the game, was a deep snapper.
Ah, perfect. Lineman. There's their
first start. Number 75 of the offense. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
What's the over-under here in the second half?
Well, it took almost, what, 3 minutes and 45 seconds to get that one in. 21 penalties in the first half. So, you know what, I'll tell you what, I think we were getting a little bit spoiled there for a little while.
A&M showed blitz, they back off. Lemche the catch in the backfield. He is quickly wrapped up by Everett and Hurd. Let's go down to Dawn.
Yeah, you guys, adding to that family tree talk, Mike and Jake's dad, Bruce Matthews. He's the offensive line coach for the Tennessee Titans with his Hall of Fame buddy, Mike Munchak, as head coach. Those two live by the really simple motto. It's be a pro, know what to do, and do it. They've posted that quote in their meeting rooms in the Titans facility, and that's a motto that Bruce has instilled in his kids. Every coach and player we talked to here at Texas A&M said both of those guys are pros. They know what to do, and they do it.
Tell you what, and they do it very, very well. The idea that you can replace a guy like Luke Jokel and really not miss a beat. In fact, when you look at it, best tackle tandem in the game last year was Jake Matthews at right tackle and Luke Jokel at left. You slide Jake over to the left and Cedric LaBoye at right tackle, and you still got maybe the finest unit that you can find at this level.
It's a holding penalty against the A&M defense, so it's second and three now. The 32-yard line. Gilbert rifles one out to the far sideline. It's caught by Steven Nelson. His first catch of the second half. That's a 12-yard completion. You don't see a lot downfield out of this offense. It's mostly sideline to sideline. Gilbert finally connects with Nelson horizontally.
You know, part of that is a function of what the defense does, what this offense, this red raid offense, it's predicated on reading what the defense is doing. A&M has kept the receivers in front of them all game long.
Batted down again. Third time Gilbert has had a pass batted down at the line of scrimmage. Second and 10. That time it was Alonzo Williams, the defensive tackle. Hal Mumme, first year as passing coordinator under June Jones. And he's the innovator of the air raid offense.
Yeah, there's so much overlap between these two teams even. So many coaches that coached with one another. Hal Mumme built his offense off of Lavelle Edwards at BYU and Miles Davis, who was kind of the advent of the run-and-shoot offense.
Another one knocked down, and it was Williams again. He is a steady inside presence at 6'4", 280, the sophomore out of Long Beach, California. Back-to-back plays where he bats down Gilbert's pass.
Well, part of it, you know, if the ball's going to come out quickly and you don't have a chance to get upfield and get to the quarterback, just stick one of those big old paws up there and ask him to throw around that. When you've got an underneath intermediate passing game, the receivers are just beyond the line of scrimmage. There's opportunity to bat those balls.
Here comes the blitz. Gilbert gets rid of it, but the pressure certainly got to him. Underthrown, off target, incomplete fourth down.
So far, you know, you come right back out. You march down the field on offense. You get a score. Mark Snyder, I think, has to be pleased. We talk about some of the younger guys that are playing. We moved DeShazer Everett over to safety for this ball game. The defensive coordinator for A&M's played a lot of young guys.
It's a fake. Loftus. Did he get the first down? No. A yard and a half short. And A&M will have good field position as they take over at the 47-yard line.
You know, these teams, SMU's trying to play to win, want to get in this ball game.
How about the tight end, Nehemiah Hicks, on the tackle to keep Loftus from picking it up?
I wonder if it was a called fake or not. It certainly didn't look like it was set up to be a fake. I don't know if he didn't think he was going to get the punt off in time and his coverage team had already released downfield or what. Maybe they give him a green light.
And Matt Jokel is coming in to play quarterback. Maybe Manziel gets the rest of the night off. Matt Jokel under pressure. And he faces a blitz on his first pass attempt. Second and 10. Jokel played the first half against Rice because of the suspension to Manziel in week one. He hasn't played since. He was 14 of 19 for 190 and a touchdown.
Continuation of this old family tree. We talked about his big brother who's over at tackle.
Yep.
All the Matthews boys play offensive line. The Jokels are more diverse.
It's a catch by Gonzalez. And he's pushed out after a 7-yard pickup. Manziel's numbers, 14 of 21, 244, a touch and a pick, and 102 rushing and two touchdowns.
Three quarters, not even three quarters of work either. You know, that's the asterisk on this. But don't expect A&M to turn into, you know, two tight end, let's grind it out and shorten the game. You see, you know, five wide receivers. This offense stays true to what it is, regardless of what personnel is in.
So third and three for Jokel and the A&M offense. Jokel throws it incomplete, and the official is run into. Ooh, that was an ugly collision. The umpire goes down hard. Malcolm Kennedy steamrolled him.
You know, Jokel comes in the game, and what does Tom Mason do? He heats him up a little bit. These aren't all-out blitzes. That time he brought five. And we saw a lot of three-man rushes with Johnny Manziel. This time, though, the 12th man for SMU on defense was the umpire. It was a good job of, well, I think he got there before the ball did. Pass interference on the umpire.
That's John Shigo. Looks like he's going to be all right as this one is sent into the end zone. Just the second punt tonight for Texas A&M. Johnny's got the visor on. His night is over.
ESPNU College Football Primetime, brought to you by Regions Bank, Regions, official bank of the SEC, and the all-new line of Gator utility vehicles. Nothing runs like a deer.
Clay Matvick, Matt Stinchcomb, Don Davenport back here in College Station. Johnny Manziel. Some great images from last week's game against Alabama. Another good night of work here tonight against SMU. 346 yards of total offense and three touchdowns. He has given away to Matt Jokel. SMU going back to work on offense. Gilbert throws. And is that complete? Jabryce Taylor making the catch just shy of the first down marker. True freshman got his arms underneath it and held on.
Gilbert delivered that football just in the nick of time. Weak side pressure coming from Nate Askew as Mark Snyder continues to bring pressure from the perimeter.
Second and one, first down, and more. Keenan Holman out over the 45. Now Johnny Manziel, great numbers the last two seasons against Alabama. Of course, last week, another amazing day, 562 yards of total offense, five touchdowns passing. Now, great numbers, again, throughout the first 4 weeks of the season, but could taking a second half of a game come back to hurt him later in the season when it comes down to decision time for people when they vote on the Heisman? Caught at the 50 by Nelson. It's a 5-yard pickup. Does that come into people who are voting into their consideration?
I think it will. You know, you think about last year, Johnny Manziel kind of burst onto the Heisman scene. Part of that was a function of Colin Klein losing a game late in the season for Kansas State. It's kind of a weak Heisman field a year ago, but also A&M beats Alabama late in the year. Well, this year they beat him early in the season, Alabama's second game of the season.
As Prescott line, he's going to bring up third down and two. I mean, taking essentially an entire half off, think of how much he could pad his stats here tonight.
Yeah, and you know what? That doesn't matter to Kevin Sumlin. He's not looking to pad stats. And you would think that Johnny Manziel wouldn't care about it either. Played one series in the third quarter.
Lions got the first down.
If you can put up 562 yards of total offense versus Alabama, you know, to me, if anybody's paying attention, as long as he continues to perform well, which he performed very well here tonight, you know, other than that dry spell of four incompletions, and let's remember that two of those were complete, they were just out of bounds. Well, I think that anyone who's paying close enough attention that has a Heisman ballot should recognize he's still the best college football player.
Gilbert pursued, and he can only throw it away. Well, let's compare his day to some of the other quarterbacks that are coming up in the Heisman conversation. Taj Boyd, Thursday against North Carolina State, a 244-yard pass in day, 3 touchdowns. Jameis Winston, the freshman sensation at Florida State. A lot of people are talking about him now. Teddy Bridgewater in Louisville, blowout win.
I think that's all we're going to see from Teddy Bridgewater in Louisville. You know, last week, we're going to scuffle to a victory over Kentucky, but you talk about being able to pad your stats when you look at that Louisville schedule.
That's batted down. Incomplete, third down and long. It's Nate Askew.
Nate Askew's had a heck of a game. You know, he's the kind of guy that gives guys like this a headache. You know, a guy that can bring pressure and may play in coverage. Look at Bridgewater. You know, Florida International is who they played today. You know, last week, it was Kentucky. You know, when you look at the slate of games, Bridgewater's going to have an opportunity every week to pad those stats and shoot his numbers through the roof.
Third down has been a miserable down for SMU tonight, and Gilbert has to eat it. They are 4 of 12 tonight on third down as Tyrone Taylor, the defensive end, who backs up Gavin Stansberry, made the play there. Fourth down.
They're going to go for it.
Now, why not?
Well, part of the operative number there is 4 of 12 is 12. That's double the number of third downs this A&M defense was even able to force. They were lousy on third downs last week because they never even forced Alabama to third down.
And now SMU calls a timeout. We'll take a timeout as well as June Jones and the Mustangs talk it over. Thanks for watching the SEC on ESPN. Very few people have left the stadium here tonight. Well over 80,000 here at Kyle Field. Fourth and 10 after the June Jones timeout. Another flag.
False start. Number 75 of the offense. 5-yard penalty. Fourth down.
Chris Weeks with the 14th penalty against the Mustangs tonight.
A tough night for Chris Weeks at right tackle. When you think about it, it's loud here. It's not that loud. You know, eventually, you got to find a way to sit in there and hold in. You know, SMU throws the football almost all the time. A few runs sprinkled in there would be a challenge, but regardless, you can't back your team up on 5 yards, especially when you're going on third on fourth.
I still go for it. Leave the punt unit where it is on the sideline, and they convert. Caught at the 30 by Holman. And down at the 28-yard line, a pickup of 19. They'll move the chains, keep the drive alive.
Great play by Garrett Gilbert. Holding in there. Not only, I mean, he had to feel the pressure because it's draped all over the back of his legs, and still delivers a strike downfield to convert.
Play fake. caught, and a short gain for Jeremy Johnson.
You know, Garrett Gilbert, he stood in under pressure several times, and look at this, you know. Big argument, was this in the grass? No, he shows some strength, stays on his feet, keeps his eyes downfield, and delivers that strike even after being backed up on fourth down.
An official's timeout as Keenan Holman is shaken up. Now the training staff is going to come out to look at the senior. Holman tonight, 7 catches for 82 yards. He leads SMU in receiving tonight.
Look, I don't know if he was cramping. It looked like he was grabbing his hamstring a little bit. I don't know if it cramped up on him or not. But as it sits, you know, you look at Garrett Gilbert's numbers tonight. He's got a pretty good night, 28 of 45. It's the 215 yards. It's kind of curious because you think, you know, you're completing all these passes. Where's the yardage? And it's a lot of it's because it's such a short passing game that they've implemented so far in this ball game. And again, that's a function of what the defense is allowing them to get. They allow these receivers and the quarterback to read the way the defense is playing them. It's not predetermined routes.
Here comes the blitz. Gilbert throws it away. Barely got rid of it before that A&M defense brought him down. As DeShazer Everett, who got the start tonight at the field safety position, moved from his normal cornerback spot to the field safety spot earlier this week. So now 3rd and 5 for SMU.
Well, again, Gilbert showing his ability, you know, he's not escaping the pocket, but he's able to shed some of that pressure with rushers draped around his feet.
Here they come again. Lobbed up. Keenan Holman, the intended receiver, and knocked down. I think Matthews got a piece of it, even though he wasn't in great position.
You know, I just didn't get quiet enough on this throw. Gilbert, Horace Matthews, bounces off the back of his helmet. Whatever it takes, this is done, as long as it doesn't end up in the receiver's hands. Holman was there, he just didn't get enough on that pass. Snyder heating up Garrett Gilbert as they've kind of neared the red zone.
Going for it on 4th down for the 3rd time tonight. They're 1 of 2. Gilbert steps away from the pressure, and he's got the 1st down. Takes a pounding at the 15-yard line by Tony Hurd and Jenkins. But he picks up 8 yards, and again, Gilbert able to keep this drive going.
Well, that time, you know, just kind of opened up. Kind of late, really. You know, dancing around in the pocket, buying some time, showing his mobility.
His dad, Gale, former NFL quarterback. He's a savvy young man, is Garrett. Brother.
False start. Number 72 of the offense. 5-yard penalty, 2nd down.
Ben Gottschalk, the only senior on this young offensive line for SMU. He takes his turn drawing a flag.
And if you'll notice, you know, where are the false starts coming? They're coming at the tackle position. The furthest from the ball, trying to hold in there, watch these defenders move around. It's a reason. It's not an excuse for a penalty.
1st and 15 to the end zone. Nearly caught. Great effort by Darius Joseph. Can't come up with it. Everett in on the coverage for Texas A&M.
It's part of the reason why they moved DeShazer Everett to that safety position, knowing that they'd be challenged in the slots. Excellent coverage by Everett. Joseph still got hands on it. Could have come up with that catch.
DeLenci, and he gets back the 15-yard line. Tremaine Jacobs making the tackle. So 3rd down and 9 for SMU. Here they are in the red zone. And the red zone has been a struggle for the Mustangs this year.
Coming in here tonight with turnovers, penalties, they had missed field goal in the opener versus Texas Tech. But this is third down, four down territory. They might just try to get closer to the sticks to pick up a first.
16th play of the drive, Gilbert unloads to the end zone, incomplete. Darius Joseph, his go-to guy, can't come up with it. And now it's fourth down. There was Everett again.
See Gilbert delivering the football, and again, might have let him just a little bit. Everett in tight coverage does an excellent job. Maybe one of the best cover men for A&M in their secondary.
They'll leave Chase Hover, the field goal kicker, on the sideline. Fourth and nine. They need the six for a first down. To the end zone. Gilbert overshoots his man. Incomplete. Texas A&M with a stand on defense.
Gilbert had opportunities with the receivers running open, but once again, a timely blitz, getting the pressure in the passer's face, and it doesn't matter if a guy's running open if you've got a defender laying right there in your lap.
More college football later tonight on the U. Wyoming and Air Force. Battle of two from the Mountain West, presented by 5-Hour Energy. Comes your way 10:15 Eastern time tonight on the U. They take over on downs. Here's Texas A&M. The offense being run by Matt Jokel. Pass incomplete. Intended for Labhart. Kevin Pope in on the coverage. Some top 25 teams blowing out opponents today. Ohio State, despite not having Braxton Miller for a second straight week, 76-0 over Florida International. This is Trey Carson bouncing off tacklers for a first down. Also Louisville with a blowout win. Teddy Bridgewater, a big day. Of course, they play in the American Conference. And SMU, the only team in the American to avoid Louisville this year. Florida State, all over Bethune-Cookman. Not a lot of great matchups this week in college football. Penalty flag down. Evans the catch.
Holding. Number 74 of the offense. 10-yard penalty. First down.
Jermaine Effetti with the hold.
What's strange is it's like A&M. You take Manziel out for whatever reason. They're kind of falling apart. You see Effetti. Yeah, he just tackles. He just tackles the pressure. You get a blitzer inside. Jermaine Effetti's a guy. He's got a couple of penalties here tonight. One was a personal foul, but he's a guy that's going to grow into a larger and larger role on the offensive front that may be without their two-star tackles next season.
Matt Jokel fires to the outside. Caught. Juke after the catch out to the 30 is Edward Pope. He's the guy who caught that alley-oop pass from Manziel last week in the Alabama game.
That was intended for Evans. You can see him rolling around. Where's he going? He's going to go to Mike Evans. Pope just happened to be in the way for a reception.
Second and eight. Trey Carson takes it back toward the middle of the field. It'll be third down and about five coming up. Utah BYU ready to get going in a little bit on ESPN2, and Wyoming and the Air Force coming your way. And we're done here. Jokel unloads over the middle, and it's caught at midfield. To the 30. And down at the 27-yard line is Williams, LeKendrick Williams, getting an opportunity to contribute here in the third quarter. It's a 39-yard hookup.
Well, up until this point, it's been very quiet for A&M offensively. Jokel throwing into traffic and placed that football where only his receiver could get it behind LeKendrick Williams for a big game.
24th first down for Texas A&M. Jokel. It's dropped by Labhart.
Watch it again. Well, Kendrick, you see where the safety's coming up. Jay Scott could have made a play on that ball. But Jokel placed it right where he needed to. Williams able to stop and reach back for the ball and get upfield.
He goes limping toward the sideline, maybe cramping up a little bit tonight. 48 seconds to go in the third. Johnny Manziel played the opening series for A&M. He's been out ever since. Down to the 22, that's Edward Pope again. Manziel with a good night in his back pocket, has the visor on. Smiles there on the Texas A&M sideline.
Nothing troubles him on the field. You can expect him to be happy-go-lucky off the field. You see there, offensive coordinator Jake Spavital, a guy that kind of tutored underneath Cliff Kingsbury when he was at Houston.
Jokel had a man wide open and couldn't connect. Jeremy Taboyo, the true freshman out of Honolulu, was all alone. Jokel overshot him.
Let's take a little bit off of this football. Overshoots Taboyo. We've seen Manziel roll to his left and throw as a right-handed passer. And you can see Jokel so frustrated. You know, his first series, he gets blitzed. He's had a couple of drops. But on this series, you can feel him kind of get into a rhythm.
49-yard attempt for Lambeau. Bingo. And they're up over 40 points. Celebrating its eighth year, sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets, Allstate, making contributions to participating universities. General scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kick. To date, Allstate has contributed more than $3 million in scholarship money. So for the fourth game in a row, Texas A&M up over 40 points.
This is the highest scoring offense that the SEC has, and you can see why. I mean, even a week ago, if you're going to point to a game where you can demonstrate your offensive prowess, it's hard to find a team that would draw more respect than the Alabama defense. And A&M ripped the Crimson Tide defensively. When we were talking with Kevin Sumlin, he said it. Look, you know, what did you stop? What did Alabama take away from you? He couldn't answer. He didn't say nothing, but it was nothing that he could cook up when we asked the question. You see, the points, they're on a tear, and it's not surprising.
You know, and we talked briefly about this in the first half. Everything that's gone on for Texas A&M, going back to the start of last season, it's coming into the SEC. Coincidentally, everything in Austin has been going the other direction. And A&M is really seizing on a great opportunity.
It was perfect time. You know, it seems as if Texas doesn't turn things around, it's like this season is circling the drain. And it seems kind of early for that to be the case.
Nearly stepping out of the end zone was the return man, but he stayed in. Look at how close this was for Jabryce Taylor. He nearly stepped out.
Nah, keep in mind, it's where the ball is. And incidentally, when it's coming out of the end zone, it's not the, I don't know, how do you describe it? The back of the end line? It has to come all the way over the end line and go to the front edge of it if you were heading into the end zone. So it doesn't matter where his foot is, it's where the football is.
Yeah, but he already made a mistake tonight.
Well, that's twice.
Yeah, he missed one there. 6 seconds to go here in the third quarter. 42-6, Texas A&M. Five wide. Another comebacker, Holman. That's the last play of the third quarter. All Texas A&M as we head to the fourth here in College Station. Johnny Manziel played a half and a series. Put up big numbers. The reigning Heisman Trophy winner. And the Aggies poised to go to 3-1. Fourth quarter coming your way from College Station after this timeout. All right, Matthew. This was moments ago here at Texas A&M, one of the great traditions. They sway before they start the fourth quarter. Gilbert completes And out to the 45-yard line is Holman. Keenan Holman the catch. 11-yard pickup. You said it before, there are just so many traditions here, you lose count.
You almost wanted to hand the fans like an itinerary, and then we're going to do this in the first quarter, and then with 3 minutes left in the third, we're going to, I don't know, you know, stand on our heads like you put your right foot in, you take your right foot out, everybody hug your neighbor and sway left and right. It makes for a great game day atmosphere.
That's why they have to have practice at midnight night before.
There's a lot to keep up with.
54th pass attempt for Gilbert. This one complete to Joseph. Out across midfield, and he is struck hard. Pays the price for that 7-yard gain. That's Tommy Sanders laying the wood.
You know, fans, we're entering the fourth quarter. We talked about Darian Claiborne's a guy that Mark Snyder wanted to get reps in the Mike linebacker position. He's able to do that. This was an ideal opponent in that they're a simple team from a formation standpoint.
Crossing routes. It's going to be a first down. Steven Nelson the catch.
Mike linebacker, oftentimes on defenses, they're in charge of getting the call in, getting the defense aligned. It's easy to do that. SMU wants to throw the football. They're either going to have three receivers to one side, or they're going to be even two receivers to either side of the formation. But next week, it gets different. You know, Arkansas team that's very run heavy.
Obioha pressuring from the edge. Gilbert steps up away from the pressure and gets the first down. Again, he is the Mustangs' leading rusher. Takes it down to the 31-yard line. Devontae Harris with the tackle. It's a gain of 14. Obioha was coming in. He's playing the spot All-American Demontre Moore held down the last 2 years. He's a guy they really like, a sophomore out of New Orleans.
Well, Johnny Manziel's out, but you see starters, the defensive front especially, they're still in the ball game. And guys, Kirby Ennis is another. They want to make sure that they're in there. They've got to get better in their front seven, especially starting next week.
Yeah, they've got a lot to work on there. Man wide open, and again, Gilbert can't connect. Holman beat his man. But Gilbert sails it over his head.
I don't know what happened with Tremaine Jacobs in coverage. At the top of your screen, though, you see him. He looks like I don't know if he was going to try to jump, if he expected Holman to just run a stop right there and turn for the football. The quarterback and receiver on the same page, but Gilbert unable to get the ball in a catchable area.
Two by two receivers. Gilbert stepping up, unloads, caught! Touchdown SMU. Holman finally got that touchdown reception. He's been open a couple of times tonight, and Gilbert just couldn't hit him. He does finally for 31 yards and a touchdown.
And it was his 34th completion of the night. You know, you look at this offense, and the guy who's running it, Garrett Gilbert, he's going to complete passes. But if there's not opportunities to get the ball downfield, if he can't get it in succession, if they can't stay out of penalties, this offense is never going to go anywhere. And that's kind of what we saw through three quarters tonight.
Chase Hilbert with the extra point to make it 42-13. So the first touchdown drive for SMU tonight. 7 plays, 75 yards in 2.5 minutes. Holman with the grab. College football primetime, presented by 5-Hour Energy back in College Station. 42-13 Texas A&M with 12:34 to go. Clay Matthick, Matt Stinchcomb, Don Davenport back here. Johnny Manziel played the first half and one series of the third quarter. 244 passing, a touchdown, an interception, 102 rushing, a couple of touchdowns. All in all, how would you assess his night?
I'd say typical. You know, this guy set the bar so high, it's kind of hard for him to get my heart rate up a little bit. You know, watching him, I think, I don't know what he has to do for me to say wow anymore. Genuinely, I mean, it becomes so routine.
Short kick, it's Trey Williams scooping it up at the 11, and it'll be dumped just shy of the 20-yard line. And Johnny is our Wrangler five-star player of the game. Doesn't even have to play a full game.
get the honor?
Really, you know, just a half in a series, shut it down. But you look at the numbers, pretty impressive, 66% on his completions. Touchdown, the interception was somewhat misleading in that that was a tip ball off of Darrell Walker's hands. But all in all, an excellent night for Johnny Manziel, quarterback.
And now we're going to see our third Texas A&M quarterback. Here's Kenny Hill, the true freshman out of South Lake, Texas. And he gets time, too, as that starting offensive line is still in there. Doesn't find anything downfield. That's a coverage play. Not quite a sack. Gets back to the line of scrimmage. Zelt Miner brings him down. Kenny Hill, a product of that great program at South Lake Carroll High School, which coincidentally runs a similar offense to what Kevin Sumlin has here at A&M.
Well, it's interesting. There was a time when Texas high school football was the wishbone. That's what they wanted to run. And now when you look at the spread, where do you go to find a spread quarterback? The first place you come is Texas. Texas high school football has become the breeding ground of this type of offensive philosophy. And you can look all the way back to when Davey O'Brien and Sammy Ball are playing at TCU, and they run spread formations. And now, you know, some of it, I think you could point to Hal Mumme. You know, when he was at Copper's Cove at high school, and he's driving up to BYU, and he's bringing these spread concepts back to the high school game. And if you're at Houston, if you're at Texas Tech, if you're at SMU, if you're at A&M, you've got high school players ready to come in and step in and play.
That is nearly intercepted. Derek Longoria, the linebacker, getting back in pass coverage. And it's going to be fourth down as Kenny Hill and A&M go three and out. Yeah, now, who is the guy that you gave ultimate credit to in coming up with the spread attack? What was his name?
You know, he's a lot like Hal Mumme. He was a high school coach out of Ohio, Glenn Ellison, Glenn Tiger Ellison.
Taylor, his best return of the night, puts SMU in Texas A&M territory, a 20-yard return for Bryce Taylor. And you got it, another penalty flag down. We were due for one.
Oh, it's been a long cruise since the last flag.
We're going to take a break. Tom Luganville talking recruiting when we come back.
In high school football in the state of Texas, the increased production and improvement of programs like Baylor, TCU, even Texas Tech has increased the strain on the Texas Longhorn programs. Now you throw into the mix Texas A&M, they have the cool factor. They're winning, and most notably, the perception of the SEC is playing so strong in the minds of prospective student athletes that maybe more than anything else is what's driving a wedge between what was formerly Texas owning the state and now all of a sudden players looking in other directions. And now as you look to recruiting, Texas A&M is becoming the premier player in the eyes of recruits looking forward in college football of 2014 class and beyond.
ESPN's Director of National Recruiting, Tom Luganville, putting it in a nutshell, what's happened in Austin and how Texas A&M and the other Texas schools are taking advantage of the downturn of the Longhorns program over the last couple of years. There's a first down catch for Bryce Taylor. Here are the rankings when it comes to recruiting for the 2014 cycle. Alabama, no surprise, they're at the top again. But there you see, yeah, Texas A&M in the top 10.
But look at the difference. To me, is you got 24 commits at Texas, only 14 at A&M, but 9 of them are ESPN 300 commits. You're getting higher quality recruits based on what these scouts are saying these kids are capable of.
Darius Joseph with the catch. He is immediately wrapped up, no gain. Isn't it interesting how things change? They move from the Big 12 to the SEC, and they're 10th nationally, but only 5th in the SEC when it comes to recruiting.
I'll tell you what, that's a function of two things. One's the success, I think, of the SEC teams and programs, but it's also where are these recruits? You look at Florida, you look at Georgia, you look at Louisiana. These are recruiting hotbeds. And where are they? They're in the southeastern part of the United States. The recruits are where these teams are.
Caught at the 19 by Joseph. First down, 15-yard grab, SMU. playing hard.
A great pitch and catch right here, Gilbert. And Joseph, you know, really, he's turned around and maybe a little bit early. It required him to have excellent extension, though, to come down with this catch, and he paid for it.
Gilbert now over 300 yards passing. Pocket collapses, and down goes Gilbert. And out come the penalty flags again.
Personal foul, hands to the face, number 99 of the defense. Penalty's half the distance of the goal line. Automatic first down.
That's Isaiah Golden, freshman out of Carthage, Texas, who's had a tough season, lost his daughter, two-month-old baby girl, a couple of weeks ago. And he has called for the penalty, hands to the face.
Yeah. Yeah, you see it right there. That's blatant. Hands all up in there, a little face massage, and he had no intent of pulling his hands down. As a former offensive lineman, that drives you crazy. Hard to block a guy when you've got a hand all in the face.
Prescott line. Straight ahead, it's a pickup of just one. Second down and goal for SMU, trying to take advantage of their best starting field position tonight. His drive started at the 46-yard line.
That's something that's kind of been lost in the story of this ball game. One of the better drives was off of the interception, but otherwise, SMU has had a good bit of field to cover to get into scoring position.
Blitz picked up. Gilbert unloads. Incomplete. Jabryce Taylor said he caught it, but the official right there ruled incomplete. Devontae Harris, the corner, is in on the coverage.
They heat up SMU when they get in the red zone. A&M bringing pressure. See Jabryce Taylor.
Ooh,
I'll tell you what, that might be worth another look for June Jones. And if the coach is up there in the booth, it doesn't look like he's going to challenge it.
Third and goal. Another one. Knocked down and now intercepted. Deshaun Hall has a blocker. Into SMU territory. A 38-yard return for Hall. There have been a ton of balls tipped tonight at the line by Texas A&M. And that is the second SMU turnover.
Got a chance to score. As you put it, Clay, best drive of the day. Once again, God, what a great play. I mean, you see it. Tommy Sanders just goes up. He just juggled the ball up just enough to get it to Hall. And then he just takes off running down the field. Mark Snyder's defense getting a stop due to the turnover.
A running play here, Brandon Williams, the Oklahoma transfer, gets it to the 41 of SMU, a 5-yard pickup. Deshaun Hall, another true freshman for Kevin Sumlin.
These guys are having to step up early. You know, a season ago in their first year, A&M stayed healthy. There was not a lot of guys with experience and ready to play. They got 11 wins with the guys they started the season with.
Williams with a first down run inside the 35-yard line. A&M has it. It was ruled down after an 8-yard pickup. Texas A&M will be at Arkansas next week. It's first road game of the season. And they'll go on bye before playing a ranked Ole Miss team. Kenny Hill, nothing to work with here. Jonathan Yenga runs him out. It's a loss of one. So Kenny Hill, the third quarterback to work. Manziel played just one series here in the second half. Matt Jokel had a couple of series, and now Kenny Hill, the rookie out of Southlake, Texas, running the offense. Second and 12. That play is going nowhere fast. And Williams is dumped behind the line of scrimmage. That's a loss of six as John Bordano, the Buck defensive end, comes in and makes the play. Kenny Hill throws it incomplete. And that's fourth down as we go under 7 minutes to play here in College Station. Kevin Sumlin, very familiar with SMU from his time in Conference USA. The Aggies. And taking care of business here tonight. Fourth punt for Texas A&M, Drew Kayser. Drops it inside the five, but it bounces into the end zone, a touchback. 6:47 to go. 42-13, Texas A&M. Johnny Manziel had one series here in the second half as we take a look back at our tire rack drive recap. Here it is. Eight plays, 78 yards, and 3:26. It made it 39-6.
Great ball to Darrell Walker. He really kind of showcased all his talents on the final drive of this ball game, showing us just how difficult he is to get put on the ground when he's outside. I know what I've learned in this ball game is the one thing maybe he can't do is run the option and pitch with his left hand. He's just going to pitch it with his right hand. He's pretty good with that right arm, so I can see why he wouldn't want to go ambidextrous.
Neil Burcham in there now for Gilbert as we've worked ambidextrous into the broadcast tonight. Very proud of you.
That was the word on my desk calendar this morning. Figured there was a way to get it in there.
Four-star recruit Neil Burcham, the number 20 quarterback according to ESPN out of the 2012 class. He's out of Greenbrier, Arkansas. Prescott line with the carry, spins out of a tackle, has the first down up across the 35-yard line. So the backup quarterback in there now for SMU. Coming up next, Wyoming Air Force. Good battle in the Mountain West. Wyoming out to a good start this year. 6 minutes to play. Neil Burcham throws it, and it's complete. Jeremiah Gaines got a yard short of the first down, but a nice completion from Neil Burcham, his first completion. It's a pickup of nine.
Last time we heard from Gaines, he had a completion, and then it resulted in an interception, or actually a fumble caused by Tony Hurd. You see him, he can be a weapon, though. That's a big target out wide.
Burcham sets, throws. He had a receiver open. It was Gaines again. Lands incomplete. So now third and one. Overall, this Texas A&M defense, is Kevin Sumlin, Mark Snyder, going to look back on tonight and say, we made some strides in the right direction?
I think so. You know, the idea that he could get some young faces, the idea that you're going to have what looks to be going forward anyway, a true freshman, at your middle linebacker position, the more reps you can get him, the better.
That's a catch for Taylor, Jabryce Taylor, into A&M territory.
We've seen Taylor tonight. Made a couple iffy decisions as a return man, but a little bit of hand fighting and fighting for the ball there. Just creating just enough space. Give his quarterback somewhere to throw the football and fit it into a tight window.
Burcham throws, and a catch made. Ryan Walker, ball pops out. Was he down? I'm going to say yes, he was down. That's a catch for Ryan Walker. And that is the 67th pass attempt against A&M.
Ball's out.
No, he is definitely fumbling that ball. And A&M recovered. And Texas A&M does take over. Donnie Baggs knocked it out.
See Bertram there. Finally gets a complete, gets a completion right over the football. My eyes did not deceive me. It looked like Sam Miller, the 12th man, was in there around for that play as well. And yet again, we mentioned Gaines gets a big catch earlier and a forced fumble. Two snaps later to get it.
Number 63 of the offense. 5-yard penalty. First down.
False start. That's one thing that Kevin Sumlin's not going to be happy with, the amount of penalties tonight against the Aggies.
I'll tell you what, not just the penalties tonight, Clay, but special teams, they got some problems now. The extra point, the field goal unit, they got some things to figure out. Maybe they got it figured out. They missed two extra points in a botched field goal attempt. As these games, as the schedule toughens, you can't afford to be giving away points after.
Bryce Dolezal on that last carry, a sophomore out of Austin, getting some work here as Kenny Hill continues to play the quarterback spot for A&M. Taking that play clock way down. That should have been caught by Cameron Clear. He had the first touchdown catch as an Aggie last week, as he started his career at Tennessee. Most powerful conference in college athletics. The SEC Network launching August 2014. We're looking forward to it. Penalty flags. Pass interference. Jaquay Williams.
Pass interference. Number 24 of the defense. Penalty results in an automatic first down.
J.R. Richardson going to be called for the P.I.
Kenny Hill challenging SMU downfield. Yeah, you can see Hurley. He got both of his arms tied up. J.R. Richardson making it pretty much impossible to catch a football. Both of your arms are pinned to your sides. Automatic first down. You see A&M. Well, they're still going to be throwing the football. Doesn't matter what the score is. This offense is what it is. Kevin Sumlin says some coaches don't care for it. They'll make personnel changes, but they're not going to become something they're not.
It's Bryce Dolezal. 8-yard run.
It's kind of interesting, Clay. We've got these two spread offenses out here tonight. And Kevin Sumlin mentioned Hal Mumme and June Jones, the offensive minds on the other sideline for SMU. They're kind of the godfathers of the spread. His offense is kind of an iteration of what they've, the groundwork that they've kind of laid with this philosophy.
Dolezal slips, recovers, and gets back to the line of scrimmage. That's it. So third and one. Reminder, Mountain West Conference action coming your way right after we're done here at College Station. Wyoming and Air Force. And last year, Dave Christensen had harsh words for Troy Calhoun, the Air Force head coach. Got in a lot of trouble for it, too. He's apologized profusely. And he promises to keep
second
his cool tonight.
Second charge time out of the half, SMU.
SMU with a timeout and 2:11 to go. It's all A&M. They're on their way to their third win of the year. For the two teams, 5:50 for A&M. 434 for SMU, but it's really been a one-sided affair right from the opening series. A&M scored. They've never looked back. And now they take it inside the 25-yard line of SMU. That's Kenny Hill, the third-string quarterback with a 17-yard run. Said it earlier, this week there weren't a lot of great matchups in college football. Next week is a different story. Looking forward to LSU, Georgia, Ole Miss, Alabama.
Ole Miss. They gave Alabama some static a year ago. A couple of 80-yard drives where the Crimson Tide had no answer. That was the first time we started hearing about the the unsafe nature of these hurry-up offenses from Coach Saban. I think really what we're understanding is that this tempo, this fast-paced offenses where they run a bunch of plays, it neutralizes some of the defensive advantages.
Well, that's what Hugh Freeze has been saying. It's just a great equalizer. As Edward Pope tumbles inside the 15-yard line, a 9-yard reception.
How crazy is it that on a weekend where Florida and Tennessee are playing, and we can genuinely say there aren't really any good games this weekend? And by good games, you know, the marquee matchups.
Top 25 teams going head-to-head.
Yeah, but the thing is, it's true. I mean, when you think about Florida versus Tennessee, and people are kind of like, eh, whatever.
Auburn, LSU.
Yeah.
Not so much.
Exactly. You're talking about a national champion a couple of seasons ago. Nobody's paying a lot of attention to it. If anything, it was, can LSU continue to road grade everybody that's in its path? Doesn't look like much change today versus Auburn.
Bolzall to the 10-yard line. 40 seconds to go as Texas A&M will get ready for Arkansas next week. They'll be on the road for the first time this year. Then they go into bye week. They'll be at Ole Miss the following week. And then that big matchup, November 23rd at LSU, looms large. 42-13. Texas A&M had enough in the tank after that emotionally draining game last week against Alabama to rout SMU again. Johnny Manziel, only one series in the second half. 346 yards of total offense for him and 3 total touchdowns. Good game for SMU, but they fall short here tonight big time. We go to the studio.